So thank you all for coming. My name is Ed Finn. I am the director of the Center for Science and the Imagination at Arizona State University. I'm also the academic director of Future Tense, which is a partnership between ASU, the New America Foundation, and Slate Magazine that explores emerging technologies and their transformative effects on society and public policy. Central to that partnership is a series of events in Washington, D.C. and New York City, and a blog on Slate. In addition to the regular editorial content we have on Slate, we also have launched Futurography, a hybrid of journalism and digital learning, where every month we choose a new technology or idea and break it down, asking about the state of the science, inviting experts to reflect on what's happening and what the major themes in the policy and research debates are. And our theme for January is the Spawn of Frankenstein, funnily enough. You can follow today's conversation with the hashtag It's Alive and follow Future Tense on Twitter at Future Tense Now. As you saw from the documentary footage of our recent editorial meeting, our work on a new edition of the novel for scientists, engineers, and creators of all kinds is forthcoming in May from MIT Press. My co-editor Dave Gustin will be here later. He's the funny one. Housekeeping items, please silence your cell phones. We're live streaming this event, so please ask the audience, that is you, I'm reading my notes, to wait for the microphone before you ask your question, and please make your question in the form of a question with a question mark at the end of the question. And most importantly, please stick around after the program because we will be having drinks. Yay! So, we call this event The Spawn of Frankenstein. Mary Shelley's novel has been an incredibly successful modern myth. And so this conversation today is not just about what happened 200 years ago, but the remarkable ways in which that moment and that set of ideas has continued to percolate and evolve and reform in culture, in technological research, in ethics since then. In February of 1817, Mary Shelley was 19 years old. She was finishing up the first draft of her book. She'd given birth to two kids, I believe, and lost one of them already. And she was an incredibly unusual person in her time. She had a very unusual upbringing. And the novel that she wrote reflects that. It brings in all of these cutting edge, exciting revolutionary things that were happening, such as the French Revolution. It brings in her bizarre upbringing as the somewhat benignly neglected child of atheist philosopher, radical free thinker William Godwin, and the looming shadow of her mother, Mary Wollstonecraft. Their home was visited by the leading intellectuals of the day, and she brought in chemistry, electricity, medical science, all of these rapidly changing fields into her work. And in many ways, it was a philosophical exercise as much as it was a novel, or as some argue, the first work of science fiction in English. The prompt for this was a dare in the summer of 1816 on the shores of Lake Geneva to write a ghost story. And in some ways, this started out as a ghost story about Mary's own lost child, but it was also a ghost story about all sorts of missing parents and missing children. And the specters of Victor Frankenstein and his creature today are very real. They seem to be getting more tangible every moment with every new breakthrough in synthetic biology, artificial intelligence, robotics. Not even poker is safe anymore from machine learning. And the questions that haunted Shelley when she first began composing this work are getting more pressing, I would argue, as we begin in very real, very pragmatic, in some ways almost quotidian ways to create life in all sorts of different ways. And so I'd like to open this event by arguing that this is not just a story about hubris, about man stealing fire from the gods, but also a reflection on scientific creativity and responsibility. The ways in which scientific discovery is not so different from other kinds of reproduction, from biological reproduction, the ways in which giving birth to new knowledge is like having a parental relationship, and the ways in which our creations and our responsibilities continually surprise us, especially in a world that is getting more complex and more interconnected. After the book came out, it went viral in a very 19th century way. It was immediately ripped off for the stage, for translations. Almost very quickly after it came out, started to be used as a metaphor in political debates and all sorts of other cultural forms and memes. And perhaps most interestingly, Victor Frankenstein predated the word scientist by about 20 years. So even before we had this notion of the modern figure of the technical investigator, the scientist, we had this flawed figure, this person who balances cutting-edge modern research and on the one hand with these ancient mystical alchemical arts that Mary Shelley balanced in her book in the context of natural philosophy. So the Spawn of Frankenstein is legion. The myths, the figures of the mad scientist, the thoughtless creator, and the creature, the monster, the demon, the abiding questions that stick with us, what it means to be alive, what it means to be human, and what our responsibilities as creators are. These are the things that we're going to be talking about today. So we will lead in with Patrick Verone talking about the notion of playing God. Patrick is writer and producer. You may know his work from Futurama.
We spent the first 10 minutes of my arrival trying to mic me, and now I've been de-miked. So give me a moment, make sure that quite literally this thing is on. Let me begin by talking about my personal background with Frankenstein. The three salient facts about me. The first time I ever went trick-or-treating by myself was in a 1965 Ben Cooper Frankenstein mask and one piece tie it in the back pajama costume. And I distinctly remember being told by my mother that it was Herman Munster, but it was Frankenstein's monster. The first movie I ever paid to see in a theater without my parents was in 1974 when I went with friends to see Young Frankenstein. My first and only professional stage performance was in, thank you for laughing at my failure to have ever had an acting career. My first and only professional stage performance was in a live reading of a 1945 radio play from a show called Weird Circle, based on Frankenstein. I played a constable killed by the creature. My big line was, so now, in addition to my direct personal connection that I have to Frankenstein, I of course have a scholarly bona fides, having read the novel for the first time 14 hours ago on my flight from DC to LA. So I come to the text, and especially to the theme of playing God, which is the subject of the first panel, from the position not as a scholar, but as a writer, as a creator myself. In fact, when I tell the story to people of how I got into show business, how I get into writing, I recall I was a young lawyer in South Florida and listening to an NPR interview. Some writer was saying that when we are creative, we are our most godlike. And I thought at the time, oh, I'd like to be God. And so 30 years later, I write TV cartoons, and that's godlike. Now, among the most relevant work to the subject at hand that I've done was Simpsons creator Matt Groening's other show, Futurama. Several times during the series, the main character, Professor Hubert Farnsworth, dabbled in Frankensteinian. Frankenstone was the character on the Flintstones. Frankensteinian creation. I have a clip that they asked me to show. This was from the first episode of Futurama that we did after a 5-year hiatus, and we had to begin the series again, reboot it, after having killed off all the major characters in the last episode of that had aired. Now that's godlike. So ignore the credits and roll clip, please. So there's a couple of things I want to emphasize from that scene. So clearly it was designed to invoke Frankenstein. I'm hoping that somebody who worked on the show had actually read the book, unlike me, with the lightning switch. But that's from the movies, not from the book itself. The second thing is that the creation of life going on here is this sort of sub-notion of rebirth or reanimation, not, you know, random creation, which is kind of a mitigating factor in the ethos of playing God. But failing having that in, we tried to make it a little more controversial by using this new technique, stem cells, and by saying that Farnsworth killed people to get those stem cells, thus undercutting the mitigating factor that it might not have been so controversial. So I mentioned those elements of the clip to highlight sort of the shorthand that's kind of developed over the past 200 years in invoking the themes inherent in Frankenstein. And my personal belief is that this shorthand has developed because of the sheer number of times Frankenstein has been adapted or produced in other media, and that the themes and metaphors of playing God have worked their way into popular culture. So let me do a little recap. So as Ed said, 5 years after the 1818 publication, there was a play produced called Presumption or the Fate of Frankenstein, which really for about 70 years was the major way that you could see a performance outside of, you know, reading the book itself. There were a couple of burlesque shows based on Frankenstein, but they're kind of lost to history, probably for the better. These first 70 years, I mean, that all changed with the advent of cinema. There were three silent films made in the teens and 20s, 19 teens and 20s, one of them by Thomas Edison himself. The dam, of course, broke in 1931 with the iconic adaptation that we saw the clip from with Boris Karloff as the monster. It had six sequels, produced all by Universal, including Meeting His Bride, His Ghost, Dracula, Wolfman, and Abbott and Costello. The British producer Hammer Films made seven films in the 50s and 60s. I found more than 40 films with variants of Frankenstein in the title, including Teenage, Space, Young, Black, and even one, His Great Aunt Tilly. There's a film out there called Frankenstein's Great Aunt Tilly. The most recent was 2015's Victor Frankenstein, which was told from Igor's point of view. Igor, of course, not in the book. And Universal is set to release a shared universe monster series with Javier Bardem as the creature in the years to come. TV has also been just as fruitful for adaptation and thematic inspiration. IMDb lists more than 160 appearances by the monster, most notably, at least in my worldview, 1973's Frankenstein, The True Story, which I believe was early reality television. There have been other plays, novels, comic books, video games, more than a dozen apps that invoke the name Frankenstein. Most of them rely heavily on building things or making yourself look like Boris Karloff. And it all sort of follows Moore's law, which is there was, you know, one adaptation in the first 70 years, a handful over the next decade, dozens in the years that follow that, and hundreds in the recent past. We will now call it Franken-Moore's law. Which brings me to another way that Frankenstein has spawned creation. The name Frankenstein itself has come to mean creation. Well, it means creation by assembling or cobbling together parts that weren't necessarily meant to be. The prefix Franken, which is even more specifically attributable to otherwise natural things that are man-made. Frankenvirus, Frankengun, Frankenfood, Frankenberry, which is a Frankenfood. In the political world, Frankenstein is an editorial cartoonist's best friend. Anytime something is developed that gets out of hand and turns on its creator, Frankenstein's monster, typically the Karloff variant, rears his ugly head. And allow me to throw out the first trump of the conference. In September of 2016, after months, there were already months of cartoons showing then-candidate Donald Trump as the GOP's Frankenstein monster, Senate Minority Leader Harry Reid actually used those very words on the Senate floor. Now, incidentally, when you enter Franken-Trump into Google, you get 10,400 results as opposed to 1,290 for Franken-Bama, which I guess people preferred Baracula, and 6,040 for Franken-Bush, which means something else. But when you enter Trumpenstein, you get 32,300 entries. And the Urban Dictionary has defined Trumpenstein as someone who voted for Trump. So in this portmanteau, he's the doctor, not the monster. So it's a rare occasion where you get to be both sides of the creation. So one final thought, and then we'll get to our panel. I believe quite firmly that Mary Shelley meant this to be the impact of the book. She titled it A Modern Prometheus. Prometheus, the Greek god who stole lightning, created humans, and caught hell for it from Zeus. Modern, which we can scoff at the notion that this woman who wrote this book the year that Queen Victoria was born in pre-industrial England would consider herself modern, but the fact is we are as far from her as she was from Shakespeare, which puts it all sort of in a, not a funny context, but an interesting context. In Shelley's vision, Frankenstein was the modern Prometheus, the hip, up-to-date, learned, vital god who chose to create human life and paid the dire consequences. To Shelley, gods create, and for humans to do that is bad, bad for others, but especially bad for one's creator. So we'll now hand the discussion back to Ed Finn to introduce my co-panelists. Forgive us if we create a scene. We are only trying to be godlike. Thank you.
Thank you, Patrick. So let me invite Patrick up here. Nancy Kress, science fiction writer, author of the Probability Trilogy, Beggars in Spain, and Yesterday's Kin, among other books, and Josephine Johnston, director of research and research scholar at the Hastings Center.
You're having a lot of trouble.
So while Patrick has his electrical fluids readjusted here.
Is it live?
It's live.
It's live.
It's a hot mic. Let me
get things started. Thank you. That was a really nice introduction to this, our topic for this panel, the question of playing God. And you alluded to this in your opening comments, Patrick, that there's a trope around this. There's a set of gestures we can make now to allude to the playing God myth, especially in the Frankenstein context, that you can do very efficiently. You know, you can have the big switch, the electricity or the lightning, the laboratory equipment. A lot of it is comes from the whale, Universal Productions. But this is a story that we've been telling for a long time. It's a human obsession. It's been a human obsession for so long that at times it seems like a kind of cliche. So my question for all of you is this an idea that's become so familiar that it's lost its moral force?
No.
Yeah.
Is a short answer. The idea that we still have the option of playing God, if anything, is more relevant now in terms of what can be done with genetic engineering and with science than it was for Mary Shelley. Her science, of course, was ridiculous, but we forgive her that because given the context of the day, what Galvani and Volta were doing, that was the best that she had available. What we have available today are, in many ways, genuine godlike powers. And I know Josephine is probably going to want to comment on this a lot, too. I write about genetic engineering all the time. And there is an enormous potential here, as well as, of course, enormous dangers. And neither one is particularly well understood, which was also true of Mary Shelley's monster.
Josephine?
Yeah, it's interesting because, so I work in a field called bioethics, which not everybody has heard of, but it's really the looking at ethical, in my case, sometimes legal and policy and social issues in science and medicine. And you'll have to forgive the accent, I'm not going to do an American accent for you. In my field, to talk about arguments as playing God arguments is actually often dismissed as meaningless, is said to be irrational, is said to hinge on particular religious ideas that do not and cannot exist, sort of be used in a secular society. So it's really interesting and somewhat disorientating to be here and feel this idea having some sort of serious weight. Now, it's disorientating in a good way because for me, because I've actually come kind of full circle in my own thinking about what this argument can do. When just like everybody else, I was a utilitarian for a long time. But then I grew up and I thought, well, you know, maybe that, you know, it's not all just about harms and benefits. And so I've started to think that playing God is actually a really useful metaphor or idea that needs some modern translation sometimes. And I'm sure becoming a parent is one of those moments where you realize that you're sort of in this position of being a creator or of having made somebody. And so it's really kind of caused me to reflect differently on it. But like I said, in bioethics, if you raise concerns about things like human dignity and playing God and hubris, you can be laughed out of the room because those ideas are not sort of officially said to have any weight in a kind of rational, liberal, academic community.
This is a question of definition. What do we mean when we say playing God? One way to look at it is remaking nature from what it would be ordinarily. And if you want to take that on the very simplest level, antibiotics are remaking God, or playing God. We're remaking nature. Many, many people would have died without antibiotics being available. But if you want to go deeper and say, well, yes, but they were there. Penicillin was there until Fleming just happened to discover it on a bunch of moldy bread. Well, his peanut butter sandwich was overdue. But if you talk about actually remaking it at a genetic level, then you are playing God. And there have been tremendous benefits from this. E. coli modified now produces insulin in enough quantities that people with diabetes have it available at a reasonable cost, which they did not before this happened. That's only one very simple example. There are many, many others. And it has produced tremendous benefits and can go on producing tremendous benefits. For me, the Frankenstein novel is value because I don't actually like it as fiction. And now, you want me to leave?
No, okay.
I'll explain later why I don't like it as fiction. But the value for it in me is that it shows both sides of technology. This can be good, this can create good things, this can be misused. But that's true of all technology. The day man discovered fire, the crime of arson became a possibility. It's a two-edged sword, and it isn't do we use it, it's how we use it.
And the other, can I say something?
Yeah, it's your turn.
It also seems to me, and this alludes to the clip from Futurama, that there are several subtexts to playing God that are not just making something out of whole cloth, that include bringing things back to life. And then also, isn't there an element of playing God in keeping something alive? Or alternatively, is it playing God to kill something prematurely? I mean, there's the same way that the Wizard of Oz is used to be a metaphor for everything, starting with William Jennings Bryan's, you know, international monetary policy to, you know, whatever the issue du jour is, I think Frankenstein becomes a metaphor for, you end up Frankensteining the metaphor to fit the story itself or the real world development, scientific development that's happened.
One of the things that fascinated me when I read the book for the chapter that I wrote for the book that was mentioned was not just so that by playing God, by making life, Frankenstein had unleashed harm on himself and people he loved, but that he also, the experience of being that person who made really changed him. And I think that's a really interesting aspect of what playing God can code for, which is not just the fact that you take power and use it and that has consequences for others and you change the world around you, but that in the process of being somebody who creates, who makes, who does that, you change who you are. And I think about this in the context of things like stem cell research or IVF or a pre-implantation genetic diagnosis or even potential use of gene editing in reproductive contexts, which are all issues I work on, where we're also thinking not just about the consequences of using these technologies for those that are made or created, but also what it does to you as a parent or to be someone who has that degree of control over someone else, how it changes you. And in the book, you know, he really suffers, physically suffers from the experience of playing God.
That's the reason I don't like the book. And I know I'm not sure not say that at a forum that's dedicated to Frankenstein, but
I don't like the book.
And she was a teenager.
And I don't like the book for two reasons. The first reason I don't like the book is that I don't believe the psychology. Okay, he is rejected, the monster is rejected by Frankenstein. He has all of these terrible experiences of rejection and cruelty and barbarity, so he turns into a killer. I'm willing to buy that. What I'm not willing to buy is the repentance at the end, which happens for no particular reason, and suddenly he's completely upset that he did all of these things and repentant about it. Sociopaths don't repent that way. And as a novel, the construction doesn't work, because there's no foreshadowing that he is going to be able to do this. That's one reason that I dislike it, that his repentance is going to come about. And it isn't as though, it was an early novel, yes, but Jane Austen was even earlier, and her psychology holds up beautifully. So that's the first reason. The second reason is what you just said. Yes, Frankenstein suffers, and the way he suffers is that every time something awful happens, he falls into a dead faint and goes into some sort of horrors that last for months, which is really convenient for the plot. And so I have problems with the construction of it as a novel, as well as with the psychology of it as a novel, as well as with the science of a novel. So what do I like about it? I like the basic idea, which is why it has persisted for so long, the basic questions it raises, as you pointed out. It raises those basic questions of playing God that resonate down through the ages. But I like the Prometheus version better.
So,
sorry.
One of the interesting things here is the way in which the playing God motif can be used to sweep things under the rug, but it's also a very familiar story to tell. And so I wonder how each of you have seen people sort of use this as a kind of, you know, as a tool, as a storytelling tool, and what the rules are of telling a good, you know, playing God story. Because, you know, Futurama, for example, is full of these moments, right? Heads in jars and playing God things. Yeah.
Yeah, well, I mean, the irony of and working in animation is that, you know, as I struggle with the concept of you know, trying to be creative, it's you're only working with your words and images. You have the voices of real people, but unlike, you know, stage, unlike live action TV or film, you are creating an entire world, an entire universe. And with Futurama, I mean, we were trying to do on a regular basis both, you know, long-standing tropes and things that were kind of topical. And the difficulty with just in the production of animation is that, you know, you're writing something today that's not going to, the soonest you're going to be able to release it is 9-10 months from now. So we had to deal with things that were somewhat evergreen. And I mean, that clip that I showed was one of about, I found three or four times when we dipped into sort of Frankenstein lore. Those of you will remember there was an episode where we were supposed to bring Fry's dog back to life, which he then decided he did not want the professor to play dog god. And we got more nasty letters from people. Because then we ended up flashing back and showing that the dog died of natural causes. The dog died of natural causes, and people got mad at us for showing a dog that ended up dying of natural causes. Well, but it was natural. What you would rather we just didn't show.
No, I'm saying you can't kill dogs. I had an
right. Awesome. You would rather we just didn't. But the fact is, it was 1,000 years later. What do you think? I didn't live forever. That would have been unnatural. And then, you know, then we also did episodes that involved, you know, cyber technology, where, you know, implants and you know, the thing, robotics that help to create, you know, or prolong life and extend powers and whatnot. And even in those, you know, inevitably you put somebody on an operating table and you strap them down James Whale fashion, and you know, you got the everything, I guess, even in the year 3000, power is mostly generated from lightning bolts as opposed to any other means. So, I mean, we were very cognizant of the notion of prolonging or extending or revitalizing life being, you know, starting with Frankenstein, not with Prometheus. We didn't go that far back.
So how about in the field of bioethics now, Josephine, if the notion of playing God is largely sort of vacated, do people, it seems in popular culture that it's still, you know, alive and well. And so what's that interface look like? How do people respond to it, or what kinds of issues, what kinds of arguments do they make in lieu of this sort of weird, you know, cloudy notion of, you know, what is God and what are we talking about here?
Yeah, well, I think people in bioethics don't always respond very well to the fact that the playing God argument means something to most people. The ordinary person on the street pretty much knows what it means, and they sort of often will have that as a concern, not necessarily a concern of like, because of this, I will not go near the technology, but they're like, oh, that's interesting technology, but I have this little concern about, or this concern about playing God. And that most of the time is just met with like, well, that's just because people don't understand science, or what do they want? No, they don't want, you know, we have vaccinations now, that's playing God, so the whole argument is dismissed. So I don't think it's met with a whole lot of sympathy. And I think also people in my field take the God part pretty seriously, so they're like, well, you must think there is a God if you think that there's an argument called playing God, and then that means something. In place of that argument, so certainly there's heaps of attention to like, well, do we really know what we're doing when we do something? And lots of examples from science of not thinking something through clearly enough. So you've seen it most recently, you're seeing it in real time right now with the reaction to gene editing technology. So in February 2015, so 2 years ago, a group published an article in Science, scientists and others calling for attention to the uses of CRISPR-Cas9 technology, and that led to this international summit that took place in DC in December of 2015, and now the National Academies of Sciences is in about 10 days going to release a report on the uses of gene editing in humans. So the reason that they're paying all this attention is because they recognize that there could be dangers associated, very practical dangers, like how do you know that it's going to be safe? How do you know it would be safe across generations in humans or in other organisms? They did a report also on gene drives in non-human organisms. So there's a clear and large body of literature and people paying attention to concrete risks and benefits. You know, what are the safety risks associated with it, and sort of a broad understanding of that. The other stuff that's encapsulated in a playing God argument, I think, or that's hinted at in it, which is not about, like, if it was safe. Like, imagine if Frankenstein turned out to be great, right? Like, he was awesome, he was kind, he was, you know, and, I mean, not Frankenstein, the monster, the creature. And Frankenstein himself felt great about it and was heralded as a hero and all the things he was hoping. So if safety is taken care of, like, what else remains, and what is that stuff? And that is something I think people in academia are pretty bad at talking about. But again, I think it gets back to this stuff about what it means to be someone who has more control and more power in a creation relationship than we've had in the past. And it's easiest to see that in parental relationships, so in what it means to be a parent, and as parents gain more control, you know, how does that feel? What is that like? Does that change the meaning of their own lives in any way? And that's a sort of flourishing type concern rather than a straight up safety related issue. And then you see, yeah, so I, so that's how kind of how I think we are responding.
One of the responses has been in concerns of safety, and that's from the FBI. You can now order online, if you find it on sale, for $140 on sale, a CRISPR kit for editing bacterial genes. This is being done in high schools in some places. The FBI has a unit now whose job is to follow up on possible uses of this to create pathogens, airborne or otherwise, out of bacteria, which is frankly not that hard to do. We have the genie out of the bottle, and there can be any number of reports issued, and there can even be any number of laws passed. And that doesn't mean that it's going to put the genie back in the bottle, because it's not. And as far as the ultimate playing God, which is germline, human germline egg and sperm editing rather than bacteria, although bacteria editing bacteria is the possibility of ending all of life if they do it right.
If they do it wrong.
Yes. Sorry. There are reliable reports coming out of China, some of which were referenced not too long ago in MIT Tech Journal, that there is editing of human embryos going on in China. In fact, they did try to edit an embryo in order to remove the gene that deals with it, that creates a blood disease, a genetic blood disease. As a follow-up to this, MIT Tech Journal did a survey of Americans trying to find out how Americans feel about editing human genes in embryo. 46% said that if it were to control diseases, they would be in favor of going in this direction. That's playing God with a vengeance. What we can do now, it's illegal to edit genes here in embryos. It's not illegal, however, to multiply, as of course you must deal with this all the time, the number of embryos that you have them artificially using fertility drugs, and then scan them genetically and choose out the ones that are not carrying, for instance, inherited genetic markers for Huntington's chorea or Tay-Sachs or any of those. That's the first step. You scan them so that you choose those that have the genes you want. The second step would be to knock out a single gene and replace it with another one. We know how to do this. We do this all the time in mice. Knockout mice are a basics for medical research. You create mice without immune systems so that you can then do the medical research to test various drugs for conditions that you give them. We could do it. It's illegal to do it now. That isn't to say that it isn't going to be happening offshore. Again, I don't mean to be a downer, because even though it doesn't sound like it, I'm in favor of genetic engineering, although not necessarily on human embryos. I think it's necessary in order to feed the third world. I think it's necessary in order to clean up pollution. I think it's necessary to advance medically. But we have the genie out of the bottle now. The knowledge is out there. It's not that everybody can use it, but more and more people can use it. It's not like creating an atom bomb where you have to round up a bunch of plutonium and get a big facility to do it. It can be done in a basement, which is why the FBI's unit is now tracking down these kinds of reports that they get from professors in biology and in genetic and engineering who feel that some students may be doing something slightly suspicious, or that there are a lot of supplies disappearing from labs more than are being used. They have units tracking this down now. The genie's out of the bottle.
So this, you know, one of the areas where I think there's the largest gap between the boundaries of technical ability and the social framework, and certainly the legal framework around what we culturally understand as possible, what we think about, is in the biological sciences and around this kind of genetic modification, synthetic biology, this whole arena. So what are the responsibilities of the science fiction writers and the storytellers in trying to bridge some of that gap? Is this something that you've thought about, Nancy?
I've thought about it a lot, because here's the problem when you write a story. Fiction is about stuff that gets screwed up. Nobody wants to read or watch a long movie or a 400-page novel where everything goes wonderfully for the character. You want your life to look like that, but you don't want to read about it. Fiction is about stuff that gets screwed up. So the temptation, the easy way out, is to take these scientific advances and to show them being screwed up so that you get Jurassic Park, so that you get all of the kind. I just finished an incredibly good novel by the Chinese writer Wang Jinkong. It's only been here in this country for a year, this novel. It's called Pathogenic, and it's a fresh and entirely different take, pathological. It's an entirely different take on the idea of biowarfare. And again, he has to write about it being screwed up because otherwise you don't have a story. But this bothers me because, again, I think we need this kind of genetic engineering. And it bothers me so much that I try to create at least outcomes in my stories that are balanced, some gain, some loss, which is what I think usually happens in real life anyway, rather than all loss, such as the end of Frankenstein where everybody is dead. They kill each other in the book, and everybody is dead. It could be Hamlet. You know, the end of the stage is littered with all these bodies.
Yeah. And Patrick, I feel like Hollywood has an incredible power to normalize certain things, right? Or frame
yeah,
conversations.
Yes. Well, here's a partial defense. I mean, I agree. The general premise is, and I think Hitchcock said this, that drama is life with the boring parts cut out. So you do. You want your life to be normal, but you don't want your drama to be like that, because then you're not going to get the viewership or the readership. And I, to your point, I was trying to think of an example of bioengineering to the good. And what came to mind is it's the bridge between Star Trek 2 and 3 from the original series movies, where they go to the Genesis planet, or the planet where the Genesis device is detonated, and it terraforms this entire planet, and the scientist who did it, she ends up saying, they see it for the first time in this beautiful, lush rainforest, and she says, "Boy, can I cook." It's not, "Boy, can I play God." So there, they and it ends up being the artifice under which, after Spock is killed at the end of the second movie,
what?
Yeah, spoiler alert from 1982. The first Spock, not the current Spock, the first Spock dies, and then he's left on the Genesis planet where, through some nonsense, he's brought back, both Mumbo and Jumbo, he's brought back to life. It's your point that it's not as interesting to do stories where, I mean, despite the Hollywood ending notion that everything, you know, it's supposed to have a happy ending. You know, these are thrillers. These are ultimately Frankenstein is a tragedy. It's, and what is tragedy? But what's comedy? But tragedy with a happy ending. So tragedy just doesn't have that happy ending. So I don't think there's a rush to do. Other than, you know, a virus movie where the entire Earth isn't destroyed. Just a portion of it made up of the people who we don't like.
It's funny because I often feel like Hollywood is the only place where some of the negatives of technology seem to be taken seriously and vividly brought to life.
You need to read more science fiction.
No, I do read science fiction. I've read it I've been reading science fiction. I'm reading science fiction now. I've read science fiction my whole life. But I feel like it's in movies and stories, it's from artists that some of the downsides of technology are actually made vivid and real, where in academic writing and in science journalism, that isn't always there. So I've kind of been grateful for the fact that those things have been explored.
I tell you though, I mean, the series television, anytime, I mean, the shows like Battlestar Galactica begin with a dystopic setup, and then in the interest of keeping characters that you like alive and continuing to tell stories, that's why you end up not having, you know, a completely fatalistic end of the world approach. But in feature films that are not part of a series, and what feature film is that? Maybe Ex Machina is a typical, I mean, there's the Frankenstein story in a recent form. Typically, TV versus film will have, because of the serialized fashion, a greater need to happy things up.
In the spirit of populism, let us open this up for questions. Yes.
Thank you. There was a discussion at the beginning about playing God and also mentioning natural causes as being an okay thing. And it sounds as if the panel is saying playing God is bad and it violates the laws of nature. Well, this is exactly what I wanted to get to. You're nodding this way. So if you would discuss that, because if we were just to leave everything to nature, we would not be able to address illness and other kinds of things that medicine, for example, allow us to do. But then that's playing God. And there is a widespread view that you actually can violate the laws of nature and that will cause negative effects.
I'm all in favor of violating nature. I think there's a lot we can improve on.
I guess I would just say violate nature sometimes and don't violate nature other times. And the problem with that is that it's like makes you actually have to think about it every time you're thinking about doing it. And people don't like that because they prefer bright lines and like rules of thumb, right? So natural good, unnatural bad. And that would be so much easier than like, well, sometimes natural is good and sometimes natural is bad. And so you have to think it through. Like, you actually have to decide. We play God, in a sense, all the time. We vaccinate our children, which, by the way, is an enhancement, which is something that is sometimes demonized as bad, too, right? Like, it would be okay to make changes to embryos that would make them immune to diseases or, that would make them not pass on the cancer-causing genes that we've identified. But we wouldn't want to do anything that would be an enhancement. It's like, well, we do enhancements actually a lot. The question is it the kind of enhancement that we think would be good for us and that we want to be engaging in or not? And we have to stop and think about it because it's not just a question of yes, good or bad. So I think the problem with the playing God argument is that you can throw it out because you can't use it in every context. And that would be a mistake as well.
Yes.
It's like, oh, playing God, well, hey, so I played God yesterday when I vaccinated my daughter, so the playing God argument is bogus. Well,
yeah,
that's too easy. That's
the trick
too easy.
Is playing God and not losing.
well said. Another question.
God and losing. In regards to the CRISPR or Cas9 complex that you mentioned, as I'm sure y'all are aware, Dr. Dowd now ultimately called for a moratorium on her own technology. And I think you see in the book as well that Victor rejects his own creation. So I wondered if you guys could offer any commentary on the process of a creator ultimately rejecting that life that he's created.
I don't think that's fair to her. She called for a moratorium on its use in humans, which it hadn't actually been used directly in humans at that time. But she was worried about, so there are so many uses of it that aren't even in human organisms or even in human cells. So she was just really wanted some focus to be brought to the potential use in adults, children, sperm, egg, embryos. So I think it's brave, actually, to do what she did, because there would have been, I think, a lot of pressure not to do that, right? Like a lot of temptation to not open up the idea that there was anything negative about this, and I think it was really brave and important that she actually said, this is a complex thing that I have helped to make, and I need everybody else to pay some attention here and help us figure out how to use this wisely, and that seems like exactly the kind of thing that we should be encouraging and rewarding.
It is incredibly rare when you think about human nature, incredibly rare to see somebody open a door and then say, no, I'm not going to walk through it. You know, when you look at the history of recent technological research.
Well, yeah. I guess so. I mean, it reminds me of people involved in atomic physics, right?
Well, we did blow up a few of them.
I mean, you can invent something incredibly powerful and understand that it could have all sorts of uses and that's now going to need some conversation and still not regret inventing it, but just really need all of us to put our brains to work to figure out how to use it well.
Robert Oppenheimer famously said, I have become the destroyer of worlds. He had some regrets about it.
Yeah.
Of course, we also don't know if there were some great scientific discoveries that were really, really bad that the scientists just
like
tore up and threw away.
Yeah, that may well happen. Interesting question. Yes.
So part of the ability to create life and watch it blossom seems to be okay, generally, and even in storytelling. But this jump-starting of life, or bringing something back to life, and then whether or not to kill it, or now that you've created it, has to live out its life. The ethical issues related to that, and possibly if gene therapy and enhancements keep going, you know, the if you could speak maybe to the ethical issues related to social inequalities, you know, the wealthy will be able to have the special treatments, but maybe the poor won't, things of that nature.
I wrote an entire trilogy about this, starting with my novel, Beggars in Spain. And it's about people who are genetically engineered to not need to sleep. I wrote it out of jealousy.
I've met a few of those.
I need a lot of sleep. I resent it. Other people get more life. But where the novel goes, I wanted to create a genetic enhancement, what you said, that has no downside. These people are not monsters. These people do not develop weird cancers. These people are not strange in any way, nor they develop telepathy or anything like that. They just don't sleep. And when I did that, I had no story. But if I followed it through, as I did, for the bifurcation of the human race, because the gene is dominant, the genetic tinkering is dominant, you end up with one strain that needs to sleep and one strain that doesn't and one that has an evolutionary advantage. And of course, it's the wealthy as well as the children of scientists who have access to this kind of thing. And that's where my story went, because again, I had to have a conflict of some sort, and there it is.
Well, thank you all. I think we are now out of time. Thank you so much for a fascinating discussion.
Already?
I know, but there will be drinks later. I think I mentioned it. So, yeah. Thank you. Invite Joey Estrich up here to introduce our next panel and to lead us off with another reflection. Joey is the editor and program manager of the Center for Science and the Imagination at Arizona State University. Thank you.
Thanks.
All right. Well, thank you, Ed, and thank you to the first panel for setting a high bar and kicking us off and making me nervous. I'm here to talk to you about a really bad Frankenstein adaptation that I love, Splice. So Splice, has anybody seen this movie? Show of hands. There's like six or seven Splice heads in here. Very exciting. Okay. Splice is a science fiction horror hybrid. It was released in 2009. And the film follows the efforts of a married couple of genetic engineers, played by Adrian Brody and the very talented Sarah Polley, who work for a big pharmaceutical company, and their job is to create genetic hybrid creatures for medical applications. They start off creating these kind of worm-like beings, but they're not satisfied with that, and so they decide to splice human DNA into the mix, and they're hoping in a kind of Victor Frankenstein-y, hand-wavy way to like revolutionize the human race, right? Like they wanna create an organism that will produce genetic material that could cure cancer, that could cure Parkinson's, that would, you know, in some, again, very hand-wavy way, just like solve all the problems that we have. And, you know, they end up creating something sentient, and it's kind of cute in like a creepy squid-like way. And so they decide to raise it in secret, of course, because as Nancy said, something horrible has to happen right off the bat, or else you don't have a story. So Splice is a modern-day Frankenstein story, and it's for those of you who are sort of science fiction and horror heads, it's crossed with the gruesome bio-horror of classic science fiction movies like Alien and The Fly. It's also frothy and overwrought. It's a little nuts. It goes totally off the rails near the end. And that messiness is precisely why I love it so much. I think it and bad movies like it, bad but kind of smart movies like it, tell us a lot about the moment we live in. And in this case, I think about the sense of distrust and paranoia we have about biotechnology and these other Frankensteinian technologies like AI and geoengineering and things like that, in this moment of, as we started to talk about already, of great possibility and perhaps great peril as well. So in adapting Frankenstein to this contemporary moment of actual human-pig hybrids, for those of you who have been reading your science and tech news this week, with designer babies, as Nancy talked about, on the horizon, the filmmakers behind Splice make important decisions about which elements of Shelley's novel to carry through and which to transform or leave out. You know, just like any adapters of a myth or well-worn story, they want to tailor it to their own social and, in this case, technological moment. And, you know, my basic premise is these decisions are really meaningful. And in this case, they shape the themes and ethical messages of the film, and they shape the ways that it departs from its source material. And so today I want to talk about one really important departure that Splice makes from Shelley's novel as a way to kind of set up this panel. My panel is about unintended consequences. So without further ado, here's a brief clip. And this is happening when the creature, which is developing at a vastly accelerated rate, is very young. Rush out and see it, seriously. Okay, so. So names are really important. And giving something a name, whether it's a human or a child or a pet or like your car, right, an inanimate object, it lets us imbue it with a personality to see it as an independent being with goals and emotions, deserving of our attention and affection. It's no surprise that so many of our friendly technology conglomerates these days are creating virtual assistants that have names and personalities. They're encouraging us to build emotional connections with their brands and to kind of imbue those brands with all kinds of associations about desires and senses of humor and things like that. In Frankenstein, Shelley very intentionally has Victor never give his creation a name. And I think this is really, indeed, quite intentional. It's awkward, I think, as a novelist to have a major character with no name. And it makes the writing harder. When referring to the creature, Shelley has Victor use a bunch of different substitutes for a name. He calls the creature a wretch, a demon, a monster, and many other terrible, insulting things. Shelley goes to all this trouble, I think, because the lack of a name symbolizes in a really powerful way Victor's rejection of the creature. You know, he abandons it right after he brings it to life. He makes no attempt to care for it, to teach it, to help it acclimate to the world. In the novel, the creature becomes violent and vengeful precisely because he's rejected. First by Victor, then by other people, largely because he's so large, so ugly, he's scary looking, right? His lack of a name brings home the idea that he's barred and shunned from human society. And the pain of that exclusion is what turns him bad. He's not born bad. Which brings us to Splice. And on the other hand, in this movie, you can start to see it here. Dren is socialized, educated, loved. Later in the film, the scientists hide with her in the barn. Or in this barn, where they create a sort of grotesque Lynchian parody of a traditional 50s suburban nuclear family. This movie has a kind of dark comedic underside to it, and it really comes out in this pastiche of nuclear family life. And these aren't perfect parents by a long shot, but they do try, and they care for Dren. They screw up a lot, but they try. And you can really see, of course, in this clip, Sarah Polley's character starting to really build a bond with this creature. And this is a really pivotal scene because you can see in the conflict between the two scientists that this is the start of transitioning, the creature transitioning from being a specimen to being a daughter. That name specimen becomes this like really sticking point between the two of them. But of course, this ends in violent mayhem. This movie ends horribly, just like Frankenstein, with death, and with a really shocking, brutal sexual assault, actually. Sarah Polley's character ends up alone and despondent, just like Victor at the end of the novel. So we end up in the same place. And so to go back to the novel, it's the lesson I drew from it is that Victor's sin, this is one reading anyway, that Victor's sin wasn't in being too ambitious, not necessarily in playing God. It was in failing to care for the being he created, failing to take responsibility and to provide the creature what it needed to thrive, to reach its potential, to be a positive development for society instead of a disaster. Splice, on the other hand, has this just very different ethical program. It has a very different lesson for us. It says that some lines shouldn't be crossed. Some technologies are too dangerous to meddle with. It's possible for scientists, these like sort of well-meaning scientists who we kind of like, and you know, we like the actors, they can fall victim to hubris. They can shoot too high. And even though they try their best, again, the experiment ends in blood and sorrow. These people, these characters do something truly groundbreaking, and they fail to predict and understand the consequences of their actions. They avoid Victor's mistake. They stick around and hold the creature close, but the unintended consequences of their actions are still catastrophic. And you know, as we've already started to talk about, we're in a moment when these Frankensteinian technologies seem to be becoming more and more a reality. AI, genetic engineering, robotics, geoengineering promise to make us healthier and more efficient, and even help to combat the existential threat of climate change. But Spice warns us that if we try to do these radically ambitious things right, and we make an earnest effort to do them right, we might unleash terrible unintended consequences anyway. We might wipe out the economy. We might give rise to the robot uprising that everybody likes to reference in their future tense pieces. We might wreck our environment even faster. And for Splice, it's just not about how responsibly we do science or whether we stick around and care and love. It's about the idea that some innovations are just a bridge too far. And so to help me continue to explore this theme of unintended consequences, I would like to welcome our three expert panelists to the stage. So first, Sam Arbisman is a scientist in residence at Lux Capital and the author of the book Overcomplicated: Technology at the Limits of Comprehension. Susan Tyler Hitchcock is the senior editor of books for the National Geographic Society and the author of the book Frankenstein: A Cultural History, which has just been immensely helpful to me in understanding and untangling all of this. And Kara Lapointe is an engineer who has worked with autonomous systems for both science and defense applications in development, fielding, operations, and policy development. So thank you so much for being here with me.
It's our pleasure.
Okay, so I'm sort of interested, you know, whether you're new to Frankenstein, relatively new, like Patrick, or whether you are kind of like someone who's lived and breathed Frankenstein your whole life. What got you interested in the first place? Susan, you know, you have this entire very encyclopedic and helpful book about the Frankenstein phenomenon. Sam, your work with inventors and technology startups and you know, seems to me to be evocative of some of the themes of the story, these creators at the cusp of something new. And Kara, I'm guessing that there's some connection between your work with autonomous systems and the autonomous system that we see in the novel in the 19th century. So I'm interested to hear from each of you kind of what resonates with you to start us off.
So my fascination with Frankenstein goes back to my my education, my fascination with the literature of the Romantics, the British Romantics, who they represent a time of culture wars as interesting as the 60s when I started my fascination with these characters and their literature, and also today. I mean, there were a lot of amazing things happening in their day, and I began with an interest in Percy Bysshe Shelley. I ultimately taught humanities to engineering school students, and I had the great opportunity on Halloween day of teaching a class on Frankenstein. And that, for that class, I actually wore a Halloween mask, green, you know, ugly plastic Frankenstein mask, and we started talking about the difference between the novel and the current cultural interpretation. And that's what started me. From that point on, I started collecting Frankensteiniana. And I have hundreds of objects. And then I wrote a book.
We should have done this event at your house. Sam, how about you?
I have them hidden away.
Okay.
So I guess my interest in, I guess, the themes of Frankenstein, the themes of, I guess, societal implications of technology more generally, began, I guess, through influences from my grandfather. So my grandfather, he's 99. He's actually been reading science fiction since essentially like the modern dawn of the genre. He read Dune when it was serialized before it was actually a book. He gave me my first copy of the Foundation trilogy. And so I've been, and a lot of the science fiction that I've been especially drawn to is the ones that kind of really try to understand a lot of the societal implications of the gadgets, as opposed to just kind of the gadgets of the future themselves. And in my role at Lux, it's a VC firm that does early stage investments and kind of, I guess, any sort of anything that's at the frontier of science and technology. And so one of my roles there is involved in trying to connect groups of people that are not traditionally connected to the world of venture and startups. And so related to that, when a lot of technologists and people in the world of Silicon Valley are building things, there's often this kind of techno-utopian sense of, like, you build something, it's this unalloyed good, it must be wonderful. But of course, there's often a lot of people who are thinking about social, regulatory, ethical, legal implications of all these different technologies. But they're often in the world of academia, and they're often not talking to the people who are building these things in the startup world. And so one of the things I've actually been doing is trying to connect these two different worlds together to really make sure that both parties are as engaged as possible. And actually, even going back to the science fiction part, since science fiction more holistically looks at a lot of the implications of these kinds of things, as opposed to just saying, okay, the future is the following three gadgets and what they're going to be. Science fiction is really good at saying, okay, here is a scenario, let's actually play it out. I've actually been working to try to get science fiction writers involved in talking to the world of startups and really trying to make them think about these kinds of things. So maybe, I don't think I've actually gotten people involved in like explicitly Frankensteinian stories yet involved, but yes.
Everybody who gets money from you guys has to watch Splice before this.
Well, it's interesting that Sam talks about this kind of holistic approach. So I'm an autonomous systems engineer, but I've worked in developing systems, using systems, the policy implications, so kind of come at autonomous systems from a lot of different angles. So what's really interesting to me about the Frankenstein story is it really seems to delve into the idea of the ethics of creation. Should we or should we not create the technology? But I think it was brought up in the first panel. When it comes to autonomy, when it comes to artificial intelligence, this technology is being developed. So I think it's really more productive to think about, okay, what is the ethics of how, where, when, why you're going to use these types of technologies? Because it's, you know, I think somebody said, you know, the genie's out of the bottle, right? These things are being developed. So that's what to me is very interesting, is kind of moving from that conversation about creating to how are these technologies actually used? You know, the thing about autonomous systems is you start to move into a world where we've used machines for a long time to do things, right? But now we're starting to get to a place where machines can move into the cognitive space in terms of the decision-making space. It's a really interesting construct that that we use in the defense world sometimes called the OODA loop, right? The observe, orient, decide, and act. And just kind of as a way to describe doing anything, right? So observing the world, you're sensing the things around you. Orienting is kind of understanding what you're sensing, and then deciding what you want to do to achieve whatever your purpose is, and then you act. Well, we've used machines for a long time to do the sensing, right? You know, we have all kinds of cameras and other types of sensors, and we've used machines to act for us for a long time. But what's really interesting with technology today is we're on this cusp where these cognitive functions, machines can move into this cognitive space. So figuring out kind of where and when and how we want machines to move into the cognitive space, that's what I think is really interesting. And I think even kind of from very early on, Frankenstein was bringing up those ideas of when kind of you bring something into that cognitive space. So that's why I think it's pretty fascinating.
So, Susan, I was hoping you could ground us in how people at Mary Shelley's, you know, historical moment are thinking about unintended consequences. As Ed said, the word scientist isn't even in use yet, but are there other ways people are thinking and talking about the ethics of creation and responsibility, and how is Shelley kind of building on the context that she's in to kind of create this theme in Frankenstein and develop it?
Yeah, well, there's an interesting intersection between her her legacy from her parents and the science going on. Her father, I find a really important influence on the novel, because William Godwin was really, I think of him as being the father of our modern day liberal concept that people aren't evil, that bad actions come because people have been influenced by hatred, by anger, by negative outside influences. That is, that evil is made, not born. And I think that that really carries through. It's as if Mary Shelley wanted to animate that philosophy of her father's. But at the same time, there are these fascinating experiments going on at the time. Galvani, the whole idea of the spark of life, what is the spark of life, and these amazing experiments, not only with frogs, which is sort of the famous one, but even with corpses, introducing electrical stimuli to bodies and making them move, making the eyes of a corpse open up, making it sit up, that sort of thing. Those things were being done at the time, and they were kind of like sideshow events that the public would go to. So there was a lot of science happening that opened up a lot of questions of, should we really be doing this? And that is a lot of the inspiration behind Frankenstein as well. You don't really see that happening in the novel, but it's so interesting that instantly the stories, the retelling of the stories, bring electricity in as the spark of life.
Yeah. So that point about social context and the sort of social constructionist beliefs of William Godwin is really appropriate, I think, and also something that her mother, Mary Wollstonecraft, was very adamant about. She wrote a lot about women's education and the idea that the way that women were educated socialized them to be submissive and, you know, sort of, she called them, like, you know, intellectually malformed and things like that. This idea that they were kind of violently socialized away from being intellectuals and citizens and full members of society. Both Sam and Kara, you know, I think you both have some interaction, you know, Sam through your book and through Lux, and Kara through your engineering work, with systems that learn and adapt, the systems that work in a social context and have to solve problems in complex ways. So is this sort of social constructionist thinking, this idea that the social context for the operation of these technologies actually affects the way they work and what they become, you know, how do we kind of react to that in this moment?
So one of the clear examples of this kind of thing, it's like the whole, like, artificial intelligence, machine learning, especially with deep learning now. This is like, we're having a moment of deep learning right now. And with these systems, and even though the algorithms of how they learn are well understood, oftentimes the resulting system, based on, like, once you kind of pour a whole bunch of data into it, the resulting thing might actually be very powerful, might be very predictive. You can identify objects and images, or help cars drive by themselves, or do cool things with voice recognition. How they actually work, kind of the underlying components and like the actual thread within the networks are not always entirely understood. And oftentimes because of that, there's often moments when, like, you're actually, like, the creators are surprised by their behavior. So we were talking about this earlier, like, there's like the Microsoft chatbot Tay, I guess a little more than a year ago, when it was, like, designed to be a teenage girl, ended up being a white supremacist. It was because there was this mismatch between the data that they thought the system was gonna get and what it actually did get, and there was this, like, the socialization in this case was wrong. And you can actually see this also in situations with IBM Watson, where they wanted, the engineers who were involved in Watson wanted the system to better understand slang and just kind of everyday language. And so in order to teach it that, they kind of poured in Urban Dictionary. And then it ended up just cursing out its creators. And that was also not intended. And so I think there's a lot of these kinds of things, like recognizing that the environment that you expose the system to and the way it kind of assimilates that is going to affect its behavior. And sometimes you only discover that when you actually interact with it. And so I think there's kind of this iterative process of, as opposed to in Frankenstein, where it's like you build the thing and build the creature, hopefully it's perfect. Oh no, it sucks. I kind of give up and run away. I think in technology, ideally, there's this iterative process of understanding. You build something, you learn from it, you actually kind of find out that there's a mismatch between how you thought it was going to work and how it actually does work, embodied by glitches and failures and bugs. And then you debug it and make it better. And I think, so rather than kind of just viewing it as we fully understand it or we never understand it, there's this constant learning process and socialization, kind of really making sure you have the right environment to make sure it gets as close as possible to the thing you actually want it to be.
There's a lack of knowledge, though, of what the forces that you're putting onto, whether it's the creature or the systems, you know, maybe we don't have the capability of fully understanding or fully knowing, like pouring the Urban Dictionary in. They didn't know what influences they were making on the thing.
And actually related to that, there's this idea from physics. It's this term when looking at, like, complex technological systems or just complex systems in general, of robust yet fragile. So the idea that when you build a system, it's often extremely robust to all the different eventualities that you've planned in, but it can be incredibly fragile to pretty much anything you didn't think about.
Right.
And so there's, like, all these different exceptions and edge cases that you've built in, and you're really proud of handling them, and suddenly there's, like, some tiny little thing that just makes the entire thing cascade and fall apart. Right. And so, yeah, it's, you have to be very wary of recognizing the limits to, like, how you actually designed it.
Yeah.
I think it's really interesting to think about the system. You know, we're using the word system to talk about a machine that's being created. When I think of system, I actually think of the interaction between machines and people, right? I mean, time and time again in history, technology comes in, innovative emergent technologies come in, and they actually change the fabric of our lives. I mean, think about the whole Industrial Revolution. I live 30 miles outside of DC, but I can drive in every day. I mean, that would be unheard of centuries ago, right? But then think of the personal computer, think of the internet. You actually live your life differently because of these technologies, right? And so we're on the cusp of the same kind of social change when it comes to autonomous systems. Autonomy is going to change the fabric of our lives. I don't know what it's going to look like, but I can tell you it is going to change the fabric of our lives over the coming decades. So it's interesting when you're talking about a system to understand that it's not kind of this one way. It's not, you know, how we're just teaching a machine and teaching a system. You've got to understand how kind of we collectively as a system evolve. And so I think that's just an interesting way to kind of think about framing it as you move forward talking about these types of technologies.
What do you mean when you say autonomy is going to be shaping our future? What is autonomy that you're talking about?
So autonomy, you know what, and there is no common definition of autonomy. Many days of my life have been spent in the debate about what autonomy and autonomous mean. So, you know, at some point you just move beyond. But autonomy is when you start to get machines to move into the cognitive space, right? You know, machines can start making decisions about how they're going to act. So the example I love to use, because a lot of people have had them, seen them, the Roomba vacuums. Right, you know, I got a Roomba, I love it, right? But it's funny because when you think of a traditional vacuum, you know, you have a traditional vacuum, you turn it on and it's, you know, what's it doing? Its job is to suck up the dirt, right? And you move and decide where it's gonna go. Okay, well, a Roomba, okay, what's its job? Its job is to suck up dirt and clean the floor. But it now decides how the pattern it's gonna follow around your room or around, you know, whatever the set space is to clean that. So it's, you know, autonomy is as you're starting to look at machines starting to get into the decision space. Mm-hmm. And I think one of the things that we really need to address and figure out as these machines come in, and it's much more than just a technical challenge, it's all these other things we're talking about, is how do we trust these systems, right? You trust somebody when you can rely on it to be predictable, right? You know, and we have this kind of intuitive trust of other people, and we know that they're not going to be perfect all the time. We have kind of this kind of understanding, you know, and your understanding of what a toddler is going to do is different than what a teenager is going to do is different than what's an adult going to do, right? So you have kind of this intuitive knowledge. So as we're developing these autonomous systems that can act in different ways, it's really important for us to also spend a lot of time developing and understanding what this trust framework is for systems. So as Sam was saying, you know, when you have an autonomous system, you know, when I turn that Roomba on, I don't know the path it's going to take around the room. Right? I don't know if it goes straight or goes left or does a little circle. I have three kids and a dog, so it does a lot of the little circles where it finds those dirt patches, right? You know, I don't know just looking at it instantaneously if it's doing the right thing. I have to kind of wait to see as it's done its job if it did the right thing. So it's deciding or figuring out how you really trust systems and test and evaluate systems is going to be fundamentally different with autonomous systems. And this, to me, is one of the real challenges that we are facing. We're facing as a society. So think about autonomy and, you know, self-driving cars. A lot of people like to talk about self-driving cars, right? And this is a technology that is developing apace. Well, what are the challenges? The challenges are, how do you integrate these into the human existing system we already have? How do you trust the self-driving cars? I mean, if there's ever one accident, does that mean you don't trust all self-driving cars? Mm-hmm. I know a lot of drivers who've had an accident and they still, you know, are trusted to drive around, right? But it's, you know, we don't have that kind of same level of intuitive understanding of what is predictable and reliable.
Yeah, and so related to that, there's, I mean, within like machine learning, I was going back, like mentioning how in these systems, a lot of them are kind of making these somewhat like esoteric decisions where they work, but we're not always entirely sure why they're making these things, and that makes it difficult to trust them. And so there's this movement of trying to create more explainable AI, actually kind of gaining a window into like the decision-making process of these systems. And so related to the self-driving cars, it's one thing like when you we have a pretty decent like sense of like intuitive sense of mind of like when I meet someone in an intersection, how they're going to kind of interact with me in my car versus their car. They're not entirely rational, but I kind of have a sense. But if it's a self-driving car, I'm not really entirely sure the kind of decision-making process that's going on. And so if we can create certain types of windows into understanding the decision-making process, that's really important. And I think back like in terms of like the history of technology, and so the first computer my family had was the Commodore VIC-20. And I guess like William Shatner called it the wonder computer of the 1980s. He was the pitchman for it. I was too young to program at the time, but one of the ways you would get programs is you had these things called type-ins. You would actually just like get a magazine and there would be code there and you would just type the actual code in. And And so even though I didn't know how to program, I could see this clear relationship between the text and what the computer was doing. And now we have these really powerful technologies, but I no longer have that connection. Like there's a certain distance between them, and I think we need to find ways of creating sort of a gateway into like to kind of peeking under the hood. And I'm not entirely sure what those things would be. It could be as simple maybe as like a progress bar, which although I guess those are only tenuously connected to reality. But we need more of those kinds of things in order to actually create that sort of trust.
Yeah, it seems to me that the ruling aesthetic is magic, right? To say like, oh, you know, Netflix, it works according to magic. The iPhone, like so much of what happens is under the hood, and it's sort of for your protection. You don't need to worry about it. But I think we're realizing, especially with something like cybersecurity, which is a big unintended consequences problem, right? We offload everything onto the internet to become more efficient, and suddenly everything seems like at risk and insecure in a way. We're realizing we might need to know a little bit more about how this stuff actually works. Maybe magic isn't good enough all the time. Yeah.
And one of the few times you actually learn about how something works is when it goes wrong. Like sometimes the only way to learn about a system is through like the failure. And you're like, oh, it's like, I don't know, like just the chatbot is becoming racist. Like now we actually realize it was kind of assimilating data in ways we didn't expect. And yes, right. These kind of bugs are actually teaching us
something. Which brings us back to Frankenstein. Because, because Victor was so fascinated and excited and proud and delighted with what he was doing. And then when he saw what he had done, it's like checking out.
Yeah.
Horrible, you know, end of his fascination and delight. Yeah, and beginning of his downfall.
I wanted to say, you know, I'm gonna kind of prompt you, Sam, that, you know, Frankenstein's very haughty about his really, you know, I think it's, you know, can read it psychologically as a defense mechanism. He's so haughty later about the creature. He's very disdainful of it. He sort of distances himself from it. You know, all the negative, all the unintended consequences it causes. He sort of works really hard to convince his listeners and the reader, you know, that he's not responsible for that, as if not thinking ahead somehow absolves him. But Sam, in your book, Overcomplicated, you talk a bit about this concept of humility, which dates all the way back to the medieval period. And I feel like the conversation we've been having reminds me of that concept, talking about how to live with this complexity in a way that's not scornful, but that's also not kind of mystified and helpless.
Yeah, so when I was writing about humility in the face of technology, I was kind of contrasting it with two extremes, which we often tend towards when we think about, when we're kind of confronted with technology we don't fully understand. And so one is the fear in the face of the unknown. We're like, oh my God, self-driving cars are gonna kill us all, the robots are gonna rise up. And the other extreme is kind of like the magic of Netflix, or like the beautiful mind of Google, of like this like almost like religious, reverential sense of awe. Like these things are beautiful, they must be perfect. And of course, they're not perfect, they're built by imperfect beings, humans. And these two extremes, the downside of both of these is they end up cutting off questioning. Like when we're so fearful that we can't really process the systems that we're dealing with, we don't actually try to understand them. And the same thing, if we think the system is perfect and wonderful and worthy of our awe, we also don't query it. And so humility, I kind of use that as like this sort of halfway point, which actually is productive. It actually ends up allowing us to try to query our system, but recognize there are going to be limits. And so going back to the medieval thing, I kind of bring this idea from Maimonides, from the 12th century. He was a philosopher, physician, rabbi, and in one of his books, The Guide to the Perplexed, he wrote about sort of like, there are clear limits to what we can understand, and that's fine. And he had like made his peace with it, and I think, in later centuries, there was sort of the scientific triumphalism that if we apply our mind to the world around us, we'll understand everything. And in many ways, we've actually been extremely successful, which is great. But I think we are recognizing that there are certain limits, there are certain things we're not going to be able to understand. And I think we need to import that into the technological realm and recognize that even the systems we ourselves have built, there are certain cases where, and it's one thing to say, okay, I don't understand the iPhone in my pocket, but if no one understands the iPhone completely, including the people who created it and work with it on a daily basis, that's an interesting sort of thing. And I think this humility is powerful in the sense that it's better to work with that and like recognize our limits from the outset so that we can sort of build upon them and constantly just try to kind of increase understanding, but recognize that we might not ever fully understand a system, as opposed to thinking we are going to fully understand it and then be blindsided by all these unintended consequences.
So, Susan, I'm going to query you on this first, because I feel like the other two are going to have stuff to say too, but I want to get the Frankenstein angle on it. So, what do we do? Like, should we, you know, how do we, what was Frankenstein tell us about how we prepare for unintended consequences, since they're inevitable, clearly? Like, we're sort of innovating and discovering very quickly, things are changing quickly. Should we ask scientists and engineers to regulate themselves? Should we create rigid laws?
do researchers need more flexible norms that they agree? You know, what is Frankenstein? You know, and what is this modern myth that we're constantly using to frame these debates kind of have to say about them?
What does the, oh gosh.
I have in my mind something that you said.
You do?
I do.
Maybe you should say it because I don't
you said something about. Well, I want to prompt you. So you said okay. Something. You said when we were like talking in advance, yeah. I was picking their
prompt
brains about
me.
This, about how secretive Victor is, about yeah. how he removes himself from his colleagues.
Well, it's true. Yes, indeed. Victor is representative of a scientist who works in secret, all by himself, does not share. And as a matter of fact, even the the James Whale film, it's the same thing. I mean, Victor goes up into a tower and he locks the door, and his beloved Elizabeth has to knock on the door to ever see him. I mean, it is perpetuated in the retelling of Frankenstein. This whole idea of a science that is solo and not. Shared. And, you know, thanks for the prompt, because maybe that's a good idea to, you know, that we share the science, that we talk about it, and I think sharing it not only with other scientists, but also with philosophers, psychologists, humanists, people who think about bioethicists, people who think about these questions from different vantage points. And talk about them as the science is being developed, that is about what human beings could do. I think that's about the best we could do.
I think this idea of sharing is really critical. So from the kind of developer-operator perspective, and I come from kind of a Navy background, military background, it's really important that you get the people who are developing systems talking to the people who are using systems, right? We get into trouble when people have an idea of, oh, this is what somebody would want, and they go off and develop it kind of in isolation, right? Maybe not secret, but in isolation. Just there's a lot of kind of stovepipes in large organizations, and it's really important to create these robust feedback loops. And we have this saying in the Navy that, you know, sailors can break any system. So you always, when you build something, you want to make it sailor-proof, right? But it's really a fabulous thing to take a new idea, take a new design, take a prototype, and give it to sailors, because there's nothing like 19 and 20-year-olds to completely take apart what you just gave them, tell you why all the reasons you thought it was going to be great are completely stupid and useless, and tell you the thousand other things you can do with a system. So I think this kind of idea of sharing in the development, so sharing in terms of talking to people who are operators, talking to people who are the infrastructure developers, right? You think about kind of going back to the self-driving car, think about how we interact with the driving infrastructure. When you come to a stoplight, what are you doing? You are visually looking at a stoplight that will tell you to stop or go. Do you think that is the best way to interact with a computer? That's really, really hard. It's really, really hard for a computer to look and visually see a different colored light and take from that the instructions of whether to stop or go. So you have to kind of include the people who are developing the infrastructure, include the policymakers, include the ethicists. I mean, you have to bring back to this holistic idea. You have to bring everybody in as you're developing technology to make sure you're developing it in a way that works, in a way that's useful, in a way that's going to actually be the right way to go with technology. And I think that's a really good example from Frankenstein, is that because he's kind of solo and designing something that to him is brilliant, and maybe if he had stopped and talked to anybody about it, they would have said, hey, maybe that's not the most brilliant idea in the world.
Yeah, and so related to this, so in the like open source software movement, there's this maxim of with enough eyeballs, all bugs are shallow. The idea that like if enough people are working on something, then all bugs are gonna be, I guess, rooted out and discovered, which is not entirely true. There are bugs that can actually be quite serious and last for like a decade or more. But by and large, you want more people to actually be looking at the technology, kind of, and also going back to like the robust yet fragile idea that you want to make it as robust as possible. And to do that, you need as many people involved kind of to deal with all the different eventualities. But you also just need the different kinds of different people from different modes of thinking to really like try to understand, not just to make the system as robust as possible, but really as well thought out as possible. And I think that's a really important thing.
And kind of crowdsourcing your development. You know, if you think about what's going on with self-driving cars, well, one of the most important things that's happening today that's going to feed into that is actually just the autonomous features in other cars, right, that are being deployed, and all this information gathering that because there are so many people out there and so many cars out there, and if there are autonomy algorithms in some of these other cars, I mean, little things. There's lots of cars today that have, you know, they help you park, they help you do all these other things, they help you stay in the lane, right? And so those can all have unintended consequences, right? But as you learn from that, and the more widely you're testing and testing this kind of incremental approach, you know, I like to say revolution through evolution, right? You know, you build a little, test a little, learn a lot. And I think that's a really good way to try to prevent unintended consequences. So instead of just talking about managing unintended consequences when they happen, try to bring as many people as you can in from different fields and try to think through what could be possible consequences and try to mitigate them along the way.
Right, and related to like the process of science more broadly, in science, and people have been talking a lot about recently about like the reproducibility crisis and the fact that there's certain scientific research that can't be reproducible, and I think that really speaks to the importance of like opening science up and like actually making sure we can share data and opening and actually really seeing the entire process and like putting your computer code online to allow people to reproduce all these different things and allow people to actually partake in the wonderful messiness that is science as opposed to kind of just trying to sweep it under the rug. And I think that's really important to really make sure that everyone is involved in that kind of thing.
So we have time for one more quick question. I actually want to address it to you, Susan, at least first, and hopefully we get quick answers so we can go to questions and answers from everybody else. As I'm listening to you all talk about diversifying this conversation and engaging sort of non-specialists, it strikes me that one irony there is that Frankenstein itself, this like poisonous framing of Frankenstein is this like, don't, you know, innovate too far, or don't disastrous outcomes might happen, like we might transgress the bounds of acceptable human ambition, that this is actually a roadblock to having a constructive conversation in a way, right? Like all of these themes that we're talking about today of unintended consequences and playing God are in fact difficult for people to grapple with in big groups. I wonder if you have any thoughts about that.
Well,
other ways to think of the novel, maybe, to recode it for people?
Yeah, you know, I think that culture has done the novel disservice. Because I actually think that the novel doesn't end. The novel does not end with everybody dead, nor does Splice, by the way.
There's a couple people alive at the end of Splice.
Oh, there's also
and of course, the company is.
There's a pregnant woman at the end.
That is true.
Uh-huh, that's what I'm thinking about. So Frankenstein ends with the monster, the creature, whatever we want to call him, good or bad, going off into the distance and potentially living forever. And also, Victor Frankenstein is, yes, indeed, he is saying, I shouldn't have done that. And you, Walton, who is our narrator, who's been going off to the North Pole, indeed listens to him, still wants to go to the North Pole. But his crew says, no, we want to go home. We're too cold.
Well, they're worried they're going to die.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I know. But there are still these figures in the novel, both the creature and Walton to some extent, who are like still questing.
Yeah, they have
still
moral agency
questing
to some extent.
Yeah, and I don't know why I got onto that from your question, but.
You refuse to see the novel as purely black at the end, I think.
Yeah, maybe. I don't, I know. I was going to say culture had done it a disservice because I think culture has simplified and simplified the story to say science is bad. Pushing the limits are bad. This is a bad guy and he, you know, shouldn't have done it. I don't think that it is that simple, frankly, in the novel or today, for that matter.
All right. Well, I am going to ask if anybody out here has questions for any of our panelists.
Thank you very much for a great discussion. I'm curious about what segment of society really wants the self-driving cars. And one of the concerns is that there'll be a lethargy that will come upon the rider, perhaps, or the one who's in the car and such, and not really ready to, let's say, your rumba. If your rumba couldn't get through, would stall because it couldn't get into it, you have to interact to reset it or something. I'm just wondering, in a self-driving car, if you're not going to be able to have to do anything, then you're not going to be maybe aware of what's really going around. So Musk is the one who started the whole idea, and yet is it going to target just a certain segment of society as opposed to, you know, everyone has to drive be in a self-driving car?
So. Well, I'm not going to speak to, I think, in terms of who's driving. I think there's a lot of people who've been driving the self-driving cars, but your idea of when you have people that were formerly driving and who are now the passengers, I think this is actually a really important issue with autonomous systems. Is one of the most dangerous parts with any autonomous system is the handoff. the handoff of control between a machine and between people, and it doesn't matter whether you're talking about cars or other systems, right? I mean, you'd be talking about a plane, an autopilot going to a pilot on a plane, right? It's a perfect example. And it's that not having that full situational awareness, right? So when you have this handoff, that's a really dangerous time for any system. So I think this is one of the challenges. And that's why when I define the system, I don't think you can just define the machine, right? You have to define the system of how is the system going to work together between a machine and a person and how they're going to work together.
We as humans don't have that capacity when you're putting all those algorithms in. We're not going to really, you can ask the machine to figure out what's the consequences perhaps. So I don't think we humans, you know, are wired in order to at that level to understand how they all fuse together and what consequence results from it.
Well, I think cognitive load is a really big issue for engineers as well. I mean, think about, we live in an age of so much information, right? How much information can a person process? And frankly, you know, you have data. There's tons of data. You have so many sensors, you can bring in so much data. How do you kind of take that data and get the knowledge out of it, right? And turn it into information. And I think that's really part of the art of some of this, is how you take so much data and turn it into information and deliver it to the human part of a system or even a machine part of the system, the right information at the right time to make the overall system successful.
And to relate it to that, I mean, there's the computer scientist Danny Hillis. He's argued that we were living in the Enlightenment when we kind of apply our brains to understand the world around us. We moved from the Enlightenment to the entanglement, this era of like everything hopelessly interconnected, we're no longer fully going to understand it. And I think, to a certain degree, we've actually been in that world already for some time. It's not just that self-driving cars are going to herald this new era. We're already there. And I think the question is how to just actually be conscious of it and try our best to, make sure we're getting the relevant information and constantly iteratively trying to understand our systems as best we can. And I think that goes back to, like, in terms of thinking about how we approach what understanding means for these systems. Like, it's not a binary situation. It's not either complete understanding or total ignorance and mystery. There's a spectrum of, like, you can understand certain components, you can understand the lay of the land without understanding all the details. And I think our goal when we design these technologies is to make sure that we have the ability to kind of move along that spectrum towards greater understanding, even if we never get all the way there. And I think that's, in many cases, fine.
I'd like us to move on to our next question. I think we have one in the back or one over here. Hi.
I want to dig in a little on the dialogue that we may all agree would be a good idea to involve more people in at the start of conceiving of these technologies. And ideally, I think we might agree that some public morality would be a good element to include. But say, hypothetically, we lived in a society where practically we're not really good at having conversations among the public that are thorny, and especially that include technical details. I mean, just say that happened to be the case. And I just want to clarify, is the value of broad public consensus and input, or is the value more on having a diversity of representative thought processes? And if the value is on something like openness and transparency, that might have a different infrastructure of feedback, whereas if it's on something about diversity of thought, you might think of a sort of council where you have, you know, a philosopher and a humanist and whatever. So I think oftentimes we end up saying something like, we should have a broad conversation about this, and that's how we'll move forward, but sort of digging in on what that might actually look like and how to get the best value in our current society.
Thank you for that question. I'm just going to ask that we keep our responses quick, just so we can take one more really quick question before we wrap up.
They're not mutually exclusive.
Oh, look at that. A quick response. Either of you want to add anything?
And so one thing I would say is, this is maybe a little bit to the side of it, but people have actually looked at when you kind of bring in lots of different diversity of opinions when it comes to innovation, oftentimes the more diverse the opinions, the lower the average value of the output, but the higher variance. So the idea is, like, for the most part, when you bring lots of people together who might speak lots of different languages and jargons, it often fails. But when it does succeed, it succeeds in a spectacular fashion in a way it wouldn't have otherwise. And so I think we should aim towards that, but recognize that sometimes these conversations involve a lot of people talking past each other, and so we need to do our best to make sure that doesn't happen.
But I think specifically to making sure you bring diverse voices from different segments of society and different backgrounds into the conversation is really important. Because when I always like to tell people, autonomy, autonomous system, it's not a technical problem. It's not like I could put a bunch of engineers in a room for a couple months and they could solve it. There are all these other aspects to it. So you need to make sure you bring all the other people. You bring the lawyers, you bring the ethicists, you bring the, you know, everybody else, you know, the users, all the different people. So I think you can just, you just have to be very thoughtful whenever you are looking at developing technology to bring all those voices in at an early stage.
Okay, one more very quick question.
Yeah, thanks. I'm Tad Daly. It's for you, Kara. In the last panel, Nancy Kress, I thought, made a very complex, sophisticated argument about genetic engineering. Has great benefits, also enormous risks. I think Nancy said gene editing, some aspects of that is illegal, but then Nancy said, but of course you can go offshore. So I want to ask you to address those same things, Kara, about autonomous systems. I think you've made clear that they have both risks as well as great benefits. Do you think it ought to be regulated at all? And if so, who should do the regulating, given that if country A does some regulation in our globalized world, it's the easiest thing in the world to go to country B?
Yeah, no, I think it's a great question. It's something that, we internally talk a lot about. I think the thing about autonomy to understand is that autonomy is ultimately software, right? It is software that you're putting into hardware systems that helps move into this cognitive decision-making space. Now, every piece of autonomy that you develop, the software you develop, it's dual use, right? So that was my earlier point in terms of, I don't think it's really useful to talk about should you regulate development, because autonomy is being developed for a lot of different things. So what you really need to think about is, okay, this technology is being developed, so how, where, when should the technology be used? I think those are the useful conversations to have in terms of, you know, how it's regulated, et cetera. You know, where is autonomy allowed to be used, where it's not allowed to be used. But the idea that you could somehow regulate the development of autonomy, I just don't think it's feasible or realistic.
Okay, I'm with a heavy heart. I have to say that we're out of time. We will all be around during the happy hour afterwards, so we'd love to keep talking to you, answering your questions and hearing what you have to say. And thank you to all of you for being up here with me and for sharing your thoughts with us.
Okay.
To wrap up, I'd like to introduce our next presenter, Jacob Brogan, who is an editorial fellow here at New America. And Jacob also writes brilliantly about technology and culture for Slate magazine. And he's here to talk to you about a fantastic Frankenstein adaptation. Thanks.
Before I shifted to writing, I was an academic. And I think the two-hour mark of conferences was the point at which I faded, to the extent that I was paying attention before. So if you'll forgive me, I'm going to try to just gross you out just a little bit, just to maybe wake you up. Earlier this week, I visited the National Zoo here in Washington, D.C., where a extraordinarily patient researcher tried to show me samples of a tiny nematodal skin parasite, a little worm, that appears to be infecting an animal species that was already facing extinction. There are several reasons why this was difficult for me. One of them, as I pointed out, not at all humbly, I'm afraid, to the researcher, I have extremely long eyelashes. I don't know if you can see from where you are, but they're quite luscious. And it's quite difficult because of that to lean into a microscope. She kept saying, pull your head back, pull your head back. But I just really wanted to lean into this experience of looking at this parasite. The other problem, which was probably more pressing, is that as you may know, if you've looked through a microscope recently and are also someone like me who barely remembers his biology classes, most skin samples under a microscope don't actually look like anything unless you really know what you're looking at. So I'm looking at these slides and just sort of trying to take it in stride and recognize that this murky pink blot that I'm looking at is, in fact, some kind of tiny worm. It's not really getting through to me, this worm, until the researcher, who had this very helpful little arrow that she could move around on the slide, points out this tiny line of black dots inside what appears to be an air bubble. They're minuscule even at the microscopic scale that we're studying them, but she makes it zoom in just a bit more, and I can see that there are these small little balls that make up that black line. See that, she says? Those are worm eggs. All of a sudden, like that, I catch myself itching at my own skin, convinced that I too am literally filthy with worm eggs, which I probably am. Is there any chance, I say, that like this stuff is on my skin? Well, no, of course not. This particular nematode is not on my skin, but thinking back to the trouble with my eyelashes, she responds, "Have you ever heard about the mites that live in your eyelashes? They're mostly harmless." And like that, I realize I'm a landscape. I'm a habitat, I'm an ecosystem. And that means that my body is not my own. At some fundamental level, I'm not me. Thanks, science. It's what I needed to know today. Now I'm going to ask them to roll a clip that you will at first think has nothing to do with nematodes. Listen to me very carefully. Watching this scene from Terminator 2, I'm drawn to one thing in particular, not the grotesque horror of Arnold paring away his flesh, although apparently it was even grosser in the original cut of the film. It's not that I'm drawn to, but rather it's the reactions of the two characters watching him, Miles and Teresa Dyson. Even before they know what's happening, but after they do, all the more so, they respond with a kind of outsized horror, screaming and writhing, as if they were the ones under the knife, as if Arnold were peeling away the flesh from their arms. Now, you might dismiss this, perhaps reasonably, as a bit of comical overacting. I'm not convinced, though, that that's what we're seeing here. I'd suggest that we're witnessing something else, something more like what I felt peering at those nematode eggs under the microscope. What they're seeing as he peels away his arm isn't horrifying because it's gross, but because it's uncanny in something like the Freudian sense. The uncanny, Freud wrote in 1919, is that class of the terrifying which leads back to something long known to us, something once familiar. He's trading here on the German word for the uncanny, unheimlich, which as I understand it means something literally like unhomely. For Freud, unhomely is not the negation or opposite of home, but that which shows us that home has always been something other than what we thought it was. Uncanny things are those things that estrange us from ourselves and our world precisely because they call us back to where we came from. Freud, in other words, and maybe not surprisingly if you know your Freud, thought that we feel something is uncanny when it brings to mind sentiments or ideas that we've repressed. While I'm not here to talk about the repressed, this is still important for our purposes today, I think, because Freud thought it wasn't the unknown that scared us most, but the known. And here, it's worth noting that the panel you're about to listen to is on the fear of the unknown. Freud wrote, "Some new things are frightening, but not by any means all." That is, it's not novelty that frightens us, although it sometimes seems to, not the newness of science or of technology in particular. And as I learned staring through the microscope earlier this week, when the new is frightening, it's mostly because the more we learn, the more alien old things begin to seem. This sentiment is also central, I think, to the scientific horror of a book like Frankenstein, where the quest for knowledge mostly serves to teach us how much larger the world is than we realized. I see something similar at work in this scene from Terminator 2, something I'm inclined to call the technological uncanny. The technological uncanny would be what we experience when new discoveries imbue familiar things with unfamiliar qualities. What the Dysons, those two horrified characters who are quaking on the floor, are realizing in this scene is that they may not be who they think they are, or what they think they are. Sorry, that was tacky of me. My papers were stuck together. There's a sort of sequel to this scene from Terminator 2 in the recent film Ex Machina, where Donahue Gleason's character slices into his own arm with a razor and peers into his mouth in the mirror, trying to convince himself that he is also not a robot. And that's the trick. Once we start to realize how much hides beneath the surface of the visible world, how many slimy things do crawl with legs upon the slimy sea, as Mary Shelley's beloved Samuel Taylor Coleridge puts it, we also begin to learn how little we know. So, this is the lesson I take from this scene from Terminator 2. It's not the strangeness of new technologies that frightens us, but the way technology threatens to make us strangers to ourselves. In a semi-Freudian spirit, then, I'd like to propose that where Frankenstein and its spawn are concerned, our fear of the unknown may really be about our discomfort with knowing. Thanks. I'll invite up, I think, Bina to introduce, or someone, to, yes.
Perfect. And she'll introduce everyone else. Thank you. To lead us fearlessly into a conversation about the fear of the unknown, let me introduce Bina Venkatraman, a Carnegie Fellow here at New America and Director of Global Policy Initiatives at the Broad Institute of MIT and Harvard.
Thank you. And I'd like to invite up our panel, who I'll introduce once you can see their faces. If anyone needs to do a seventh inning stretch, feel free moving around in your chairs. So we have here with us today, we have Dave Gustin, who is a founding director and a professor of the School for the Future of Innovation and Society at Arizona State University, and Charlotte Gordon, who is the author of Romantic Outlaws, The Extraordinary Lives of Mary Wollstonecraft and Her Daughter, Mary Shelley. And she's also a distinguished professor of the humanities at Endicott College. And Anna Lee Newitz, who is the tech culture editor at Ars Technica and the author of several books, most recently Scatter, Adapt, Remember, How Humans Will Survive a Mass Extinction. So we have a great panel here. And despite the billing that this is about the fear of the unknown, in talking amongst ourselves, I think maybe a more apt name for what we're going to talk about would be Fear and Loathing from Frankenstein to the Future. We really want to explore fear writ large, fear of the unknown, fear of the known, as Jacob so aptly brought up, fear of the hideous and the strange, and look at how the themes of that carry from Frankenstein into how we think about science and technology today and how we think about the future. So Charlotte, if you would not mind kicking us off as our expert on the life of Mary Shelley, what do we really know about how Mary Shelley intended to represent fear in Frankenstein? What was she trying to say about her own fear, about the fear of others, and what can that tell us?
Thank you. Did you set Jacob up ahead of time?
No, we talked not at all, no. So
that was perfect. I mean, I think that, you know, it's funny because Frankenstein has gone down in history as, you know, the first novel of science fiction. It's about science, it's about innovation, it's about the future. And I think another very interesting way to read Frankenstein is to see it as political commentary and a real exploration of what Mary Shelley feared about what she knew, which is why I thought Jacob's introduction to our panel was so perfect. And what was it that Mary Shelley knew? Well, she was born in 1797. And so if we just pause for a second and think about what it meant to be a woman in 1797, it wasn't a lot of fun. Women could not own their own property. They couldn't have money. They could not initiate a divorce. Their children were considered their husbands. According to sort of English political theory and English thought, nothing was more dangerous and harmful to the kingdom than disorder. And so the role of men in English society was to keep women, their daughters, their sisters, and their wives under control. It was the responsibility of the man or the husband to discipline his wife The only rule was that the whip that he used should not be thicker than the thumb. That's where we get the idea of the rule of thumb. So in many ways, you can read Frankenstein as a real exploration and a real condemnation. This might be a little bit of, you know, hard since we don't have the text in front of us and you're not my students, so I can't, you know, browbeat you into opening the text. okay, we do have the text in front of us, right? Really, it's important to remember that most of the people, most of Mary Shelley's contemporaries did not think that the situation for women was bad. You know, that it was just how it was. But Mary was different because not only, as Susan pointed out, was she the daughter of William Godwin, rock star political philosopher, even more importantly, she was the daughter, thank you, Joey, of Mary Wollstonecraft, radical feminist who wrote a vindication of the rights of woman and was an international superstar amongst liberals and radicals and was called a whore and a hyena in petticoats by everyone else. And there were a lot of them. Unfortunately for little Mary Shelley, her mother died 10 days after giving birth to her, but Mary read all of her mother's books, and by the time she was 12 or 13 years old, she had decided, I am going to live according to my mother's ideals. I am going to be a beacon of freedom. I am going to fight for justice for all people. And she dedicated her life, in fact, to living according to her mother's ideals. Really interestingly, as she's writing Frankenstein, she suffers two terrible experiences, which are two young women that she was close to killed themselves. Why did they kill themselves? And her own mother, Mary Wollstonecraft, had also tried to kill herself twice. Why? Because throughout the 18th century, throughout the 19th century, what was more monstrous to English society than an unwed mother? Or worse even than that, a woman who thought for herself, an independent woman, an ambitious woman, and an intellectual woman. So Mary Shelley, when she's writing Frankenstein, is thinking, as I know it's strange to think about, but she's thinking less about technology than she is about the social ills that she herself has endured and that those close to her have endured. And she's really describing a world, if you think about it, in which there are no mothers, in which the ideals of, as she saw it, of femininity or of women, and we would complicate that discussion now, but for Mary Shelley, did not exist. So Victor Frankenstein works in isolation rather than a community. He's driven by ambition and by, you know, self-promotion in that sense. And then he doesn't nurture or educate his creation. He's a horrible parent. This is terrible, thinks Mary Shelley. And the only voice of sanity in the entire novel is off stage. It's Walton's sister that he writes to, who writes letters to him. And in fact, that's really how the novel ends, I just have to say, is Walton listens to his sister who says, stop with the ambition already. Leave North Pole, come home, and be with your family and live in community like a normal human being, like a good human being is the implication. So what is Frankenstein really about? It's about all the things we've been talking about today, but it's an incredible, damning political commentary about life in England during Mary Shelley's life, but on into now, too. There's, of course, implications.
So have we been reading this wrong? So when we think, I mean, aside from reading it wrong, but when we think about the fear of the unknown, we carry on this idea, like Frankenstein is synonymous with horror and fear, right? Are we reading this wrong and thinking that she was trying to tell us to be afraid? What is she actually condemning being afraid of the unknown, in this case the unknown being femininity or women?
That's such a great question. Well, I'm a writer, I'm a thinker, so I don't think any reading is ever wrong. So no, I loved everything we've been talking about, and I think the applications are all there for us. But I do think that if there is a sort of moral to Frankenstein, that who did Mary Shelley herself most identify with? Probably the creature. You know, as Joey said, the unnamed creature. Why? Because that's how people responded to her. As an intellectual woman and as an unwed mother, she was called a whore. When people found out that she wrote Frankenstein, they said,
What kind of woman would write such a book? She must be something wrong with her. There's something perverse about a woman who would write such a book. So later in her life, she says, oh, I wrote it, but that's because the idea came to me in a dream. And we know that isn't true because we have her notebooks. She, in fact, thought of the idea. She worked on it really hard. She worked on it really hard while people around, young women around her, were killing themselves. And also, incidentally, she was reading the history of slavery. So she's dedicating herself to the ideas of social injustice and the suffering of those who are considered monstrous by their own society, herself included. So she sees herself as a woman who's trying, who wants to publish and be smart in her world, as someone who's going to evoke feelings of monstrosity? People will react to her as though she's a monster, and she's saying, don't do that.
Interesting, too, if you think about the way Frankenstein has been adapted, especially throughout the 20th century, is that slowly the narratives have become a lot more team monster rather than team Frankenstein. And it's been fun to watch these. Yes, because we're slowly starting to sympathize more with the monster. And I think we can look at that in the, I've always been team monster.
Me too.
I just want to lay that out there right now.
I feel so bad for the monster.
And I think the monster, we should feel terrible because the monster is horrifically abused. Like you said, if we look at the monster as a stand-in for a woman who's thinking independently or someone who's been enslaved, you know, this is a creature who is responding to circumstance. The creature has only ever experienced cruelty. So of course he, you know, dishes it out. He's only experienced violence and rejection. So of course he dishes it out. But I think if you really want to sort of complete the arc and go all the way up to the present day and think about a modern Frankenstein narrative, Westworld, the new TV series, is a fantastic example. And in fact, the great thing is that, of course, Westworld is also an adaptation of a previous narrative which had male protagonists, and of course now it has female protagonists and African-American protagonists, and it's very much explicitly about what happens when you're a creature who's been made by an indifferent kind of corporate science. I mean, there's some complications there, and we could talk about Westworld drinks afterward, but I think that, you know, that's a narrative where we are fully sympathetic to the creations and the creatures, and we understand that they're being abused, that their minds are being tormented by the act of creation, and that their only hope for freedom is violent uprising. That's their only hope. And to gain control over the means of their own production, which actually happens in a fantastic episode, sorry, spoilers, where they learn, one of the characters learns how to take control of her own programming. And it's such a fantastic scene. It would be like if Frankenstein said, all right, screw you, or sorry, if Frankenstein's monster said, screw you, Frankenstein, I'm gonna remake myself to be better. And so I think we have seen that come full circle, and I do think that that is a response to cultural changes and to, you know, how people understand the process of making an artificial being, which of course is becoming more and more realistic in an age of robots. So
that is one of the holes in the plot of the original novel. The creature actually uncovers Victor's notes from that had not been revealed to the reader previously. And you say, well, creature, if you're so smart, do it yourself. Don't ask the guy to do it for you. But it, you know, to turn it back to this framing of the fear of the unknown, I want to know who's responsible for that. It wasn't Joey, probably. It wasn't Ed. But
it's Frankenstein.
It was by committee. Okay, so this is, by framing it as a fear of the unknown, it puts the knowers in control of whether there is fear, of what exactly the response is. And if you sort of tick down a list of what characters in the novel are actually afraid of, these are real threats to dearly held values. There's fear of loss and loneliness. There is fear of the other. There's fear of disharmony. There's fear of female sexuality and power. There's fear of the inversion of the master-slave relationship. These are real things that are really operative to Mary and to other people in her society. And by these things getting sort of pushed off to the side, the same way that we think of, say, Luddism as a movement of ignorance and reaction, when there were real values, the real people being able to put food on their table and provide for their families, we do something different that's probably not good for the way we want to ask questions about contemporary science and technology.
Well, I think this is a great point, and it's important to complicate this idea. Or is it really the unknown we're afraid of, or is it something else? And I think contemporary psychologists would say, well, actually, we're more afraid of what's salient. So we're more afraid of a terrorist attack because we see it on the news, and it's constantly being reiterated for us. It's an availability heuristic, or the terminology. But we're less afraid of a distant problem like climate change because we see less of it, though we're seeing some more of the impacts of that. And I'm just so curious, you know, how, David, for you, thinking about areas of science and technology, do you think it's the fear of the unknown that complicates and leads to most of the controversies we see around new areas of technology like nanotechnology, artificial intelligence, or do you think there's something else at play, and how's that?
Yeah, no, I think there's a lot more at play, and actually what I would also want to do around that kind of framing is turn it around to figure out who the we is as well, because the we is never unitary. The we is sort of this, you know, composite monstrous kind of thing, and we have a variety of social and technical means to try to figure out who that we is. You know, so we just had an interesting election that, and we heard about, you know, Trumpenstein and Franken-Trump previously, but, you know, we have these interesting composites of machines and people and orders and behaviors and rules that try to create what the we is, that try to constitute who we the people are in this country. And it turns out, well, you know, it gets really messy when you try to do that. And you use some rules, say the number of people who voted for somebody, and you get one result. And you use a different set of rules, the number of people in certain states that total up certain numbers of electors, and you get a different result. So figuring out who that we is that is feeling what it is that we want them to feel is incredibly difficult too.
And so let me put it to you another way. How often does fear operating on the part of the public or politicians factor into the development of science and technology? Like, what can you tell us about recent developments in science and technology and how you see fear playing a role in their development or non-development?
Well, you know, I'm going to push back again subtly because you know, usually the way this is cast is that the scientists and the engineers, the technologists, have the knowledge. They are the ones who operate rationally, and the public is either accepting of or afraid of the kinds of things that they're offered. Well, you know, why do a lot of things get created anyway? Because of fear of loneliness, fear of death. and so it's not the case that fear and knowledge operate in a dichotomy, that people with knowledge operate out of fear as well. And the people who are normally cast as afraid in the Frankenstein films, the folks with the pitchforks, have, you know, rational responses in many instances. And so I really actually want to move, not just move the unknown off to the side, but I want to move the fear off to the side also, because I think it's fairly destructive in talking about how it is that, go back to the previous panel, that a whole mess of different people can come together and talk about what it is that we want out of new science and technology, and not simply a reaction between the rational and the afraid.
Well, it's an interesting question you raise, and I'm going to pierce through that dichotomy as well, because I think we assume that fear is irrational. But aren't there a lot of fears that are perfectly rational? If you're standing on the edge of a cliff, it's pretty rational to be afraid, right? So, is it rational? What level of fear about emerging technologies, and Annalee, I'd love to hear your perspective on this, is rational to bring into the conversation, or is productive in the conversation? How should we be talking about our fears in a way that helps guide us?
I mean, it's a good question. I will always remember when I met the synthetic biologist Drew Endy, who's at Stanford now, and he told me, "I hate Frankenstein because it's wrecked my career." And he was quite passionate about it, and he really felt that because he was doing genetic engineering, which of course was not designed to be used on humans, it was gonna be, you know, used on really quite safe projects, and projects where they built safety concerns into their into their experiments from the beginning. But he felt that whenever you use the phrase genetic engineering, people would immediately jump to the Frankenstein fear, and they'd say you're playing God, or you're trying to destroy nature, as if nature is something that we can quantify, and as if we haven't been changing nature for like over 8,000 years using agriculture. Everybody always forgets about agriculture and how we actually have radically transformed tons of species, animal species and plant species, for a long time. and so I think that, you know, there's a certain amount of, there's a number of questions that we have to bring to any project, whether it's autonomous cars or genetic engineering, around safety and around unexpected outcomes. And that kind of goes back to telling different stories other than Frankenstein, because Frankenstein is a scenario. If you want to look at it that way, it's a scenario where a guy who's a total dick makes a monster, and you know,
fearless.
Maybe, I mean, or maybe he's actually full of fear, you know, maybe he's actually, you know, building it out of a fear of loneliness or something like that. But he creates a creature and turns it into a monster. And he neglects it and he mistreats it, and yeah, it turns out to be a really bad situation. But, you know, there might have been another way out. You know, there might have been a way of rearing that creature as a child and sending it to school and doing all kinds of nice things for it. Maybe, you know, give it a college education and healthcare. you know, all those things might have really helped the outcome for the monster. Maybe give it a name, too, while you're at it. And so I think that a great idea would be to have a whole set of stories that we can tell that aren't just Frankenstein, that are counter stories about what would be a good outcome. Like, you know, what would be a version of this kind of scientific experiment where we do the right thing, or we're kind of, as Sam was saying in the previous panel, you know, kind of have a middle of the road approach where we're not really totally ignorant and fearful and we're not completely in control, but we kind of iterate. And so I think there's a lot of, you know, narratives out there like that. There's actually a fantastic project that's going on right now, which is about the Anthropocene, which is the kind of geological era that we're in now that's sort of human created. And there's a lot of fears about climate change, obviously, and what our role in it as humans is. But a bunch of universities have gotten together and created a set of stories about how to have a good Anthropocene. And actually, you can find it online. It's called goodanthropocenes.net or something like that. They're stories taken from real life, but also science fiction, about moves toward actually caring for the environment in a sustainable way, using technology or using other techniques, just sort of thinking about, well, what would be a good outcome? And not a perfect outcome where we're all living in like a super land with like, where we're all 8 feet tall and live forever. But, you know, where we do okay. You know, we don't destroy the world, but we muddle through and we manage to repair the things that we do wrong.
That's fascinating. But, jump in, Dave. Yeah.
The two pieces from the Frankenstein genre that appeal to me in exactly that way are, of course, Young Frankenstein, highlighted when Gene Wilder goes into the cell with the creature and warns them not to open the door no matter what happens. You know, he panics, he pounds the door, and then he says, "Hello, handsome." And it's that moment when he decides to love his creature. And of course, that goes to Frankenweenie, which is, you know, not a Frankenstein story, but a boy and his dog story. But the point, of course, is that the creator is working with a being that he has this deep connection with, and, you know, loves to the ends of the earth. And that's the, you know, this sort of perfection of the love of the creature interpretation.
But there's also Frankenhooker.
Highly
recommended, actually very underrated narrative from the 1990s, Frankenhooker, which is actually ends with a kind of collective uprising of the women who've been abused and turned into this creature. So it's kind of awesome.
Which is also where Penny Dreadful is going.
Yes, Penny Dreadful, another key Frankenstein narrative, yeah.
The thing that's interesting about the original Frankenstein is that she embeds, I love this idea of many stories. I think you're so right that that's kind of where hope lies, and it will help us get to this sort of middle ground or the complicated ground, entangled, you know, or help us with our entangled ground. And I think one of the things that that Mary Shelley embeds in the novel is the creature's innocence. Because if you think about it, when he begins, that's why the sort of the loving of the creature is so moving in these other stories, is that he's very well read. He gives himself essentially his creator's education. He reads Paradise Lost. You know, he spends a lot of time hoping. I mean, that's the sort of irony of it. He spends all this time hoping for this beautiful connection, which is why I love that you know, we're on Team Monster for a while there, hoping. And so I think you're so right that if we have these other stories, or in my mind, what I did most recently for Slate was I ended up changing it so it wasn't an open letter from Dr. Frankenstein to Elon Musk, but that's how I first thought of it. And what I ended up doing instead was I just said, here's three lessons that Victor Frankenstein should have learned, and you, Elon Musk, with OpenAI, can benefit from. And, you know, the idea of not working in isolation, the idea of putting many brains on a project, not just to stop the bad, you know, tyrant who's going to get hold of the invention, whatever it is, and not just to sort through the bugs, but also, of course, to, you know, I'm the historian, I'm not the futurist, so I won't talk about what all those minds can do. But the third one also was funding. Like, he, you know, Frankenstein had very poor funding. And that, you know, that's why the monster, I hate saying monster, that's why the creation was kind of funny looking. I mean, if you had to go dig up from a bunch of different graves an arm here and a leg there and, you know, a skull that doesn't match, you're not going to have a beautiful thing either.
Maybe Frankenstein needs to testify before the House Science Committee. Like, that could be a really beautiful
interface. I think
that
would be great. Yeah, because the other thing Frankenstein didn't do is, with the lack of poor funding and the isolation, Frankenstein did not prepare the public for the advent of his creation. So he was not out there telling people, this kind of funny looking thing is going to be coming charging out of the woods. Don't be scared. Say greetings. Say hello, handsome.
Say hello, handsome.
Say hello, handsome. I'm so happy to meet you. Have you read Paradise Lost?
Right. Yeah. Right. So I think
he didn't talk to the users.
He did not talk to the users.
Did not do any kind of, you know. Nor, to be fair, did he talk to his creation once it became alive. And I think that's the difference between kind of the science that we're talking about now and maybe science we'll be doing in 50 years, where if we're actually creating entities that can make their own decisions and have something like human consciousness, maybe it won't be exactly like it, and maybe it won't be 50 years, maybe it'll be 200 years or 1,000 years or whatever, but how do you do that? Like, what kind of rules and ethics do you have when you're creating a being that is a human equivalent? I think then maybe you have to go toward thinking about children and how do we treat children, which we don't have a great record with. But
And that's where I think some of the discussion in the previous panel, in the second panel around autonomy, just didn't quite reach it, because I don't think you can read this novel and have an uncomplicated idea of autonomy and even think about trashing the word. In a way, no matter whether you're talking about humans or whether you're talking about systems that humans create. Because a whole part of this is wrapped up around how it is that creatures, whether they're created naturally or created otherwise, constitute themselves and are constituted through interactions. And the very concept of autonomy sort of bleeds away when you have that complication. So if you're thinking about creating an autonomous system out of hardware and software, well, the autonomy that you've made is one that is constituted through a whole lot of programmers, a whole lot of people who put stuff together, the whole lot of users that you, and the sailors. And so what does the concept of autonomy actually mean when this thing is constituted in all these diverse kinds of ways?
I think you're raising a really important point, which I might cast in a little bit under the veil of predictability and unpredictability and sort of loss of control, if you want to go back to the loss framing. And I think that one of the things that's so challenging when we talk about areas of science and technology in my area, climate change, is that there's a lack of control for any individual person on how you address it, and then there's a whole lot of unpredictability and sort of how it plays out over the future. And I'm just thinking about your book, Emily, and just how you're trying to project us into this future where we face mass extinction. How do we even get at these problems that are sort of unknown and uncertain, where we have very little control, It seems to me that the fear can either cause us to just sort of hit the panic button or cause us to completely look away. Is there any way that we can get past that kind of fear when we think about the future?
I mean, I think that's what was so interesting about the introduction about the uncanny and how what we're really afraid of is the stuff that we're basically forcing ourselves to forget. It's stuff that we already know, but we're trying to look away, as you said. And I think with things like climate change, which is what, of course, would lead to mass extinction in many cases, you know, you can't, the way forward, I mean, part of it is storytelling, as I said, sort of thinking ahead by having a narrative. And that narrative doesn't have to be science fiction. It can be something that we get from climate modeling. A lot of the best work that we have on the future of the climate is coming from people who are taking data and using that to project into the future, you know, what we might see from sea level or what we might see from temperatures. And those are stories too. Those are stories about what's going to happen to the shape of the planet. We also have models of what happens to you know, an ecosystem when enough species die out. You know, you get to a point where if enough species die out, then you get more species dying out and more species dying out, and we can model that too. All of that sounds horrible, and people don't want to think about it, and that's the moment when people kind of shut down and they want to forget. And that's why I think it's, again, it's important to think in terms of a middle way, instead of saying, okay, every single day we must confront how terrible we are and how we're killing everything and everything is doomed, versus, you know, everything is fine. We have to have a sense of, yeah, we're gonna screw up. We screwed up, but we can fix it. And when we fix it, well, maybe it won't be perfect, but it'll be a little better. And so there has to be a certain amount in these, in our stories and our thinking about the future, and even maybe our science, of a willingness to forgive and try again and try again. And when I say forgive, part of that, what I mean is forgive ourselves for screwing up. Because if you keep telling yourself you're terrible for having screwed things up, that is when you go into the shutdown mode. And that's what happens to Frankenstein. You know, he realizes he's screwed up and he just runs away from the problem.
So do you disagree with so Nancy on an earlier panel was saying, oh, you know, when things go well, it just makes for a crappy story, right? So, but I hear you bringing up a couple of times now that there can be there's a positive story of implications of science and technology, there's a positive story we can tell about the future. What's the way to make that a good story?
A great example would be Kim Stanley Robinson's novel 2312, which is about the year 2312, so it's set in the future. And it's a story about a future solar system, and Earth is there, and Earth has kind of fixed a lot of its environmental problems. They're doing things like raising Florida back up out of the ocean, and they've de-extincted wolves by building asteroids where they have artificial environments to de-extinct animals, and so they shoot all these wolves down onto the planet to let them, I mean, in safety bubbles. They're not, no wolves are harmed in the repopulating of the wilds. But they screw up all the time. People kill each other. There's a horrific conspiracy to, you know, wreck all of these plans. There's no simple, like, when we tell a good story, it has to be just kind of like a good enough story. And so it becomes an interesting story when you think about all the conflicts involved in trying to fix the mess. The mess is there, we're trying to fix it. In the process of trying to fix it, we're gonna make a new mess. When we raise Florida up out of the ocean, that's gonna wreck a bunch of new ecosystems that have formed. If all of the ice melts in the Arctic, say for example, a whole new economy will spring up in the Arctic. So if we re-ice the Arctic later, we're gonna screw up that economy. So there's always new ways to screw things up, even if you're fixing old problems. And so I think that's the acceptance that we have to have, is things are always gonna be ambiguous.
I wanna open it up to questions, but do you have a final thought on that?
Say, I wish Mary Shelley were here. By the way, her name was not Mary Shelley when she wrote this book, just so you remember.
Mrs. Percy B.
Yeah. She was not married, she was an unwed mother. Just wanna remind you of that. You know, she didn't stop with Frankenstein. There was more Spawn. And the next book that she was gonna write is called The Last Man, which is about a disease, a mysterious disease, wipes out all of humanity except for a few people who have many wooden conversations. I mean, it's not a great novel, but she finds her way out of the very, you know, sort of dystopian dilemmas that she keeps dreaming up. I mean, her novels, honestly, they're just not fun to read because she's really a philosopher and a thinker. So ideas dominate, and people being real and having actual conversations that we can follow just aren't important to her. But by the end of her fiction writing career, and she goes on and she writes 5 more novels, what ends up happening is, or what ends up happening is very complicated, but essentially the idea of community, of coming together in community, that heroes, she says in by the, her last novel, there are no heroes. All of the men are weak in her novels, and what ends up saving people is the idea of women coming together and saving men from their ambition and learning how to live together in a kind of communitarian, flawed, but still better than the sort of last man universe. So I wish she could be on the panel, because she'd have a lot to say.
She would have gotten like an A++ on the Bechdel test, right, where the women have to, are supposed she, to have real conversations.
She totally would have, right. Men. The heroes,
yeah,
hero.
Right. Yeah. All right, so let's open it up to some questions. I'm sure there's some interesting thoughts and questions. Questions encouraged, of course, with question marks. Anyone? Is anyone afraid of asking a question? Why are you afraid?
Fear of the unknown.
I'm not sure how to frame this, but I guess I've just been thinking a lot about the ways that Mary Godwin Shelley's novel has had unintended consequences of its own in the way it's been interpreted and reinterpreted so many times in culture, and I'm sure that sort of comes up all of the time in Frankenstein, but I suppose I would be particularly interested to hear anyone on this panel's thoughts about that. Was there something inherent in the novel that, you know, intended the consequences, you know, the sort of massive mythological effect that it's had? Or has culture, you know, done a real disservice to the novel, creating a myth that it itself has needed and continues to need?
I just want to answer historically to begin with before we talk about the metaphysical implications, which is Mary Shelley made not a penny out of Frankenstein, that only 500 copies were published in the first edition, and not all of them sold. I mean, they didn't all sell. She made no money. And the reason why the name Frankenstein in the story became famous is because in England during that time, playwrights could just rip off novels freely, right? So the story itself gets popular on the stage, and no one has to adhere to the novel itself. But the name Frankenstein and the story, therefore, becomes known by the public, but people aren't sitting around reading the novel. So there's, right almost from the beginning, there's a detachment between the actual text and then the story as she's told. And I think another, like a corollary question is, why does everyone think that Frankenstein is the monster? And isn't right? That mirror thing between Frankenstein and his creation. But so I just have to be a historian.
Yeah, and I think that's such an interesting point, because I think that Frankenstein has become so well known because of all these adaptations. I mean, it's kind of the first fanfic phenomenon. Fanfic is when fans write their own versions of stories or set in the universe of their favorite stories. And so, you know, a lot of the adaptations of Frankenstein end up having the same kinds of conversations in a weird way that we've been having about, are we team monster or are we team Frankenstein? And it allows us to have this kind of productive debate, but in the realm of fiction. So it's not too scary. We don't have to be talking about actual scientists and actual politicians. We can say, well, you know, why was the monster wronged? And, you know, what did Frankenstein do wrong? And I think you see that played out in these adaptations, you know, and some of them are super team monster. Some of them are just like, the monster's horrible and can barely talk, and it's really all about poor Frankenstein. Some of them create whole new characters.
But there is, as you said about Druendi, this issue of scientists perceiving it as an anti-science creed.
Yeah.
When people talk to scientists and engineers, a lot of motivation for them to do what they do, to do science for good in the world, actually comes from science fiction, undifferentiated between whether it's sort of pro-science science fiction or anti-science science fiction. And my favorite example from Frankenstein is not from the novel, but from the 1931 film, where Earl Bakken, who was the inventor of the transistorized pacemaker, saw the 1931 film as an 8 or 9 year old boy, became fascinated with the connection between electricity and life, and created this essentially Frankensteinian technology in his garage in the mid 1950s.
And so I don't know if there's anybody from NSF in the room right now, but Ed and I have fought this little battle with NSF about how much we identify the word Frankenstein, the reference to the novel and the films, with work that is being sponsored by the National Science Foundation because of this issue.
Now we can go forth and see the novel as a woman-centered novel, even though there's no women really in it, they die. You know, the other thing is that it's a half of a marital battle that she was having with Percy. So for the literary people in here, Percy goes on and writes a long poem called Prometheus Unbound, which is almost exactly the opposite vision of Frankenstein. Science is going to help us in every way possible. And
I'm back.
We'll get you too.
With a question. So I just wanted to see what you all thought about the thing that scares Victor the most in the novel, it seems, is to create a female creature, to create a bride, right?
Yeah.
I mean, and so it strikes me that, and maybe the points that you brought up, Charlotte, about femininity and politics at the time explain that, but it seems striking to me that the thing that seems to horrify him the most, beyond words really, and causes him to become violent is the specter of a female creature.
I have so many thoughts about that, but I'm so curious to know what your thoughts are.
I will say super briefly that I think that is less a fear about femininity than it is about the racial other. Because what he's afraid of is that these two monsters are going to go off and make babies.
Yeah,
and they're going to take over Europe. Oh, my God. What do you think that's about? I don't know.
It doesn't sound relevant
to me.
That would have been precisely what I would have said as well, that it's the new race. It's a new race.
But there's one passage about the female, the potential female creature being so strong that she could take any mate that she wanted if she rejected the creature.
Yeah, so miscegenation too. Yeah. That's ooh, dark place.
Okay, we're going to take one last quick question. We just have a couple of minutes from the gentleman in the glasses here who had his hand up. And then we get to the booze, so we have an incentive to speed this up.
So the two things that have been going through my mind in the last few minutes is the Industrial Revolution and also the huge upheaval in the democratic and monarchy structures in Europe at that time. And I wondered if that sort of fear is implied in any of Frankenstein.
I'm sorry, I'd like to jump right in. Mary Shelley was deeply involved in the political systems and in protest against the political systems because of her own beliefs, but also because of her mother, her father, and ultimately her husband, Percy. So yeah, I think that Frankenstein can be read, as I think I've now said for the 5,000th time, as a political novel, that this is a novel about race, it's about gender, it's about the social injustices as she saw it. I mean, it's a real cry out against social injustice. As for the Industrial Revolution, it worried the Shelleys. The Industrial Revolution worried the Shelleys, but I would say that they were excited by innovation, technology, and science in general. That she herself, if she were here on the panel, which I'm imagining, she'd be pretty pro-science on the one hand. It's male, unchecked male ambition, racism, and inequality that she's against, not science.
Although it's interesting because I think Frankenstein, especially later, gets read as a figure for the proletariat, and that he, you know, because not Frankenstein,
the
monster.
Monster.
Sorry, I have fallen totally into the trap. The monster is read as a figure for the proletariat, and especially the fact that the monster is made from parts.
Cool.
I think that's part of the kind of assembly line idea that this is a creature that sort of, you know, almost sums up what industrial production is like. And oftentimes, the Frankenstein monster is kind of contrasted with Dracula, who kind of comes at the end of the 19th century, who's the sort of aristocratic monster, although also represents a bunch of other stuff too. So I think that the Industrial Revolution does kind of haunt Frankenstein and the monster, but especially in later adaptations, especially because Frankenstein does rise up, and kind of slay his maker and
the creature.
I'm sorry. I apologize in advance
no, but
for
that's
every.
That's fascinating.
Yeah.
And there's I'm a political scientist by training, and there's this wonderful frontispiece to some addition, and there's actually real research to be done still on this stuff, to an addition of Hobbes' Leviathan, which was probably, I mean, the book had to have been in Mary's father's library, whether this particular edition was there or not, which shows the Leviathan, which represents the body politic as a composite being. Okay, so we've got all these different composite beings running around, not just the creature, but the governments that we constitute in liberal society, the corporations that we constitute, that are bodies that are fictional bodies that can earn profits, can endure past the lifetime of their owners, and so we have all these composites that we haven't figured out how to control yet.
Wow, so I don't. Cool. If we can't find resonance today in Frankenstein from that, I don't know how we could. Thank you all so much for a wonderful, wonderful panel.
Let me just say thank you all for coming. If you're interested in learning more about Frankenstein, visit the Future Tense channel on Slate for cheat sheets, quizzes, a video about Frankenstein. You can also learn more about what we're doing at ASU around the Frankenstein Bicentennial Project at frankenstein.asu.edu. And now I invite you to please join us in the foyer for refreshments.